رمضان جانا وفرحنا بو بعد
الصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وقل جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهوقا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي My respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Alhamdulillah, it's a pleasure and honor for me to be back in Qatar after about 5 years. And this is my third visit to Qatar, alhamdulillah. Last time I think I was in 2005. And it's a pleasure to be back in this country, in the city of Doha, especially in the holy month of Ramadan. I would like to thank the Qatar Guest Center, as well as the other co-organizers and sponsors, for making it available for me to address this audience. The topic of this evening's talk is Media and Islam, War or Peace? Media, by definition, is means of mass communication. Media, in short, is means of mass communication. Islam comes from the root word salam, which means peace. It's also derived from the Arabic word silm, which means to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Almighty God. So Islam in short means peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Almighty God. So the topic of this evening's talk is means of mass communication and peace acquired by submitting your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. War or peace? We have to agree that today media is a very important tool. Rather, it is the most important weapon today. Because today, media can easily convert black to white, day to night, hero into a villain, or a villain into a hero. It's easy. This is the power of media. Therefore, I call it the most important weapon for today. And this media can be used for both purposes, for good purposes as well as for bad purposes, depending upon how you utilize this media. Briefly, in short, media can be divided into four categories: the print media, the audio media, the video media, as well as the information technology. As far as the print media is concerned, it can be further divided into periodicals as well as non-periodical media. In the non-periodical media, we have the literature, that is pamphlets, booklets, books, etc. In the periodical media, we have newspapers, newsletters, magazines, which are published either daily, weekly, fortnightly, monthly, quarterly, or annually. As far as the second type of media is concerned, it is the audio media. There are various formats of audio media. We have the audio tape, which has been obsolete. We have the audio CD, the audio DVD. We have the iPod and various different media. On the higher level, we have the DAT, etc. This audio media can be used on individual level, whether with a desktop model in the office or at home, or when a person is traveling in a car, in a train, in a plane, having equipment attached to the vehicle. Or it can be used while walking or running with a Walkman, Discman, iPod, etc. It can be used in a group level in social gatherings or on a public level through the radio broadcast station where it can reach multitudes of people. The third category of media, it is the video media. Where previously we had the video cassette, which is obsolete now. Then we had the video CD, the video DVD. Now we have the high definition DVD, we have the Blu-ray. On a high level, we have the DV cam, digital beta cam, high definition, etc. This too can be used on an individual level, like the audio media, on public level, or it can be used on a public level through the cable TV, through the television channels, or through the satellite channels. The fourth category of media, it is information technology, which is used through the internet or through the computer. Same on an individual level, group level, public level, through homepage, web page, we have the Facebook, we have the Twitter, and very different kinds. This, in short, are the four different types of media. And each of this media has an advantage and a disadvantage. Today's scientific research tells us, as far as the print media is concerned, when a normal human being reads any material, he remembers approximately 10% of what he has read. When a normal human being hears something, he remembers about 20% of what he has heard. When a normal human being sees something, he remembers 30% of what he has seen. And if a person sees and hears together, that is a video, he remembers approximately 50% of what he has seen and heard together. Each of this media has its advantages and disadvantages. The print media, though it has 10% of retention power, it has the advantage of being easily portable. You can carry it anywhere. Whether you're traveling, it's easier. As science and technology is advancing, the portability of all the different media is increasing. But yet, print media will never become obsolete. It will have its own impact. Today, what we find in the international media, whether it be the international newspapers, international magazines, the radio broadcast stations, the satellite channels, on the internet, we find there is virulent propaganda about Islam. We find that the international media is bombarding misinformation about Islam. It is spreading information about Islam which is alien to Islam. And today, there are various different strategies used by the media. And we find in the international media, they say, war on terror, war for peace. It is rather war on peace, or to simplify, war on the religion of peace. And the media uses various different strategies to reach its goal. Today we'll discuss the various strategies used by the media for its agenda of war for peace, or rather war on peace. That is war on the religion of Islam. The first strategy used by the media is they pick up black sheep from the community of the Muslims and they project on the media as though they're exemplary Muslims. We know there are black sheep in every community. So what they do, and there are some Muslims who may not be following the Quran, who may not be following the guidance of the beloved Prophet, and may be doing things which are against humanity. So the media picks up these black sheep of the community and they project as though they are exemplary Muslims. We should not judge Islam based on what individual Muslims do or what the Muslim society does. Islam should be judged according to the authentic sources. That is the glorious Quran and the authentic hadith of the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. For example, if there is a latest 600 SEL Mercedes in the market, and a person wants to test drive, he wants to know how good the car is. Mercedes 600 SEL, latest in the market, 2010 model. And a person who does not know how to drive the car, he sits behind the steering wheel and he bangs up the car. I'm asking the question, who will you blame? Will you blame the car or the driver? But naturally the driver. If you want to know how good the car is, you look at the specification. What is the pickup? What is the average? What is the ratio? What are the safety measures? How many airbags does it have? Does it have anti-braking locking system? All these, and then you will judge based on the specifications how good the car is. If you really want to test drive the car, you'll put behind the steering wheel a driver who is an expert. Similarly, if you want to judge Islam, you have to judge Islam based on the authentic sources. That is the glorious Quran and the Sahih Hadith of the Prophet Muhammad. And if you really want to test drive the car, as I mentioned, you have to put behind the steering wheel, an expert driver. The best exemplary Muslim is the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad. So if you want to know how good Islam is, you have to read the seerah and understand the life of the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So one of the major strategies used by the media is to pick up black sheep of the Muslim community and portray as though they're exemplary Muslims. The second strategy used is they quote verses of the Quran or the hadith of the Prophet, they quote out of context. And that's how they present a complete different picture of Islam. And one of the most common verses quoted by the critics of Islam is the verse from the Quran from Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 5, which says that wherever you find a kafir, you kill him. So these people project that the Quran says, wherever you find a kafir, that's a non-Muslim, the Quran prescribes that you should kill him. And when you open the Quran, Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 5, and if you read, this verse does exist. The Quran does say that wherever you find a kafir, you kill him. But this verse is quoted out of context. To know the context, you have to start from verse number 1 of Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9. And here we come to know that there is a peace treaty between the Muslims as well as the mushriks of Makkah. And this peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the mushriks of Makkah. By the time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reaches verse number 5, he is giving them an ultimatum, a warning, that put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise a declaration of war. And then the verse continues that in the battlefield, Allah is telling the Muslims that where you find an enemy, where you find the kafir, don't get scared, kill them and wait for them in every stratagem of war. So this verse is revealed in the battlefield. But natural, for example, if there is a war going on between US and Vietnam, and in the battlefield, if the army general, to boost up the morale of the soldiers, he will but naturally say to his soldiers that when you find the enemy, you kill them. He will not say that run away. He will not say get scared. Suppose the president of USA, when a war is going on between US and Vietnam, says to the American soldiers that don't get scared, fight them, kill wherever you find the Vietnamese. It is in context. But today, if I quote him out of context, I will make him sound like a butcher. But naturally, to boost up the morale, this verse is revealed in the battlefield. That in the battlefield, when the enemies come to attack you, don't get scared, fight them and kill them. And many a times, these critics, they put a full stop where there's no full stop. Or they jump to verse number 7. And one of the famous critics of Islam in India, his name is Arun Shuri, he writes in his book, A World of Fatwas. He quotes this verse, Surah Tawbah chapter 9, verse number 5. And from verse number 5, he jumps to verse number 7. Any intelligent person would realize that verse number 6 has the answer to his disease, has the answer to his problem. Verse number 6 says that if the kafir, if the mushrik, if the non-Muslim seek asylum, escort them to a place of security so that they may hear the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran does not say that if they want peace, let them go. The Quran says if the enemies, if the mushriks, if the kafir seek asylum, if they want peace, don't just let them go. Escort them to a place of security so that they may hear the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, the most generous army general, maximum may say that let the enemy go. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, escort them to a place of security. And you will read in the Quran, wherever you find in the Quran uses fighting as the last resort to maintain peace. And whenever it uses, wherever these words are used, always the next verse, invariably, we'll be talking about peace. And it says that peace is better than fighting. Invariably, anywhere you pick up. But the media, they quote out of context and they present to the world as though Islam is a religion of violence. Islam is a religion of terrorism. The third strategy used by the media is they pick up certain verses or certain words of the Quran and they mistranslate it. And today, the most misunderstood word in Islam is the word jihad. Not only is it misunderstood by the non-Muslims, because of the media, it's even misunderstood by the Muslims. And today, most of the people think, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, that any war fought by any Muslim for any reason, whether it be for power, whether it be for fame, whether it be for money, any war fought by any Muslim is called as jihad. Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim for any reason, whether it be for power or for money or for fame. Jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to strive, which means to struggle. In the Islamic context, jihad means to strive and struggle against one's own evil inclination. Jihad in Islamic context means to strive and struggle to make the society better. Jihad means to fight against oppression. Jihad also means to fight in the battlefield for the human rights. So jihad basically means to strive and struggle. For example, if a student is striving and struggling to pass the examination, in Arabic we'll say he is doing jihad. Anyone who strives and struggles, in Arabic we say jihad. And in Islamic context, if he's striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say he's doing jihad fi sabilillah, striving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many people have a misconception that jihad can only be done by Muslims. In fact, there are verses in the Quran which say that non-Muslims did jihad. Quran says in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14, Allah says, we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. In travail upon travail did the mother bore you, and in years twain was the weaning. And the next verse says that, but if your parents, Surah Luqman chapter 31 verse number 15, but if your parents strive and struggle, do jihad, to make you worship someone else besides Allah, of whom you have no knowledge, then do not obey them. But yet, live with them with love and compassion. The same message is repeated in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 8. We have enjoined on the human beings to be good to their parents. But if their parents strive and struggle, do jihad, to make them worship somebody else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they do not obey them. But yet, live with them with love and compassion. So here the Quran is talking about non-Muslim parents who are doing jihad, who are striving and struggling to make their children worship somebody else besides Allah. So here Allah is referring to non-Muslim parents who are doing jihad fi sabi shaitan. That means the Quran says that even non-Muslims do jihad. But what we Muslims are supposed to do is jihad fi sabilillah, striving and struggling in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many a times, this word jihad, it is translated into English as holy war. Holy war in Arabic, if you translate, is Harbu Muqaddasa. This word holy war or Harbu Muqaddasa appears nowhere in the Quran. Neither does it appear anywhere in the Hadith. This holy war was first used to describe the Crusades, when the Christians, when they spread the religion of Christianity at the point of the sword by force and tortured thousands of human beings to accept Christianity. That time, the word holy war was used for the Crusaders. Today, that word is used for the Muslims, for jihad. Jihad does not mean holy war. And unfortunately, not only do the non-Muslims, but even so-called Muslim scholars in inverted commas, even they translate jihad as holy war. Jihad does not mean holy war. Jihad basically means to strive and struggle. This is how the media, they pick up certain verses from the Quran, from the Hadith, and they paint a wrong picture. It is the duty of us Muslims that we should convey the correct message of Islam to those who are not aware of it. And it's very easy. And the master key for doing this, according to me, is the verse of the glorious Quran from Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3. Verse number 64, which says, "Ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa'in bayna baynakum." Come to common terms as between us and you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illallah. That we worship none but Allah. This verse of the Quran shows us a way how to speak with different types of people. That come to common terms as between us and you. And I had an opportunity many times to interact with non-Muslims. I'll give examples of when I interact with Christians, whether it be the immigration officers, whether it be the police, and they ask me the question, that do you believe in jihad? I said, yes, I believe in jihad. Jihad means to strive and struggle. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, believed in jihad. It's mentioned in the Bible. No, do you believe in fighting? So I said, when I read the Bible too speaks about fighting in the book of Exodus. Chapter number 22, verse number 27 and 28. In the book of Exodus, chapter number 32, verse number 1 to 18, it speaks about fighting. In the book of Numbers, chapter number 31, verse number 1 to 18, it speaks about fighting. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 22, chapter number 19, verse number 27. In the Gospel of Luke, chapter number 22, verse number 36, he said, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, take the sword and fight. So then the Christian tells me, no, this is a fight which Jesus Christ told to fight against the evil people. I said, that's what the Quran also says. And depending upon who you are interacting, the strategy is the same, but the matter will differ. Ta'ala ila kalimatin sawa'in bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as been us and you. And you know, India is a different situation altogether. Doing da'wah is more difficult. There we have the Hindus. But there when I speak with my Indian non-Muslim Hindus, and when they object on Islam, and they say that Islam is a religion of violence, Quran promotes violence, I tell them that if you read Mahabharata is one of the sacred scriptures of the Hindus, there is more verses of fighting in Mahabharata than in the Quran. The Hindu tells me, no, but that's a fight between good and evil. So I said that's the same fight in the Quran also. So then they say there's no problem with the Quran. And if you read Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavad Gita is the most widely read religious scripture by the Hindus. It's an advice given by the God, by the Lord, Shri Krishna, to Arjuna in the battlefield. It is 25 chapters of Mahabharata. And there, in Bhagavad Gita, in chapter number 1, verse number 43 to 46, Arjuna, he puts his weapons on the ground in the battlefield, and he tells Shri Krishna that I would prefer being killed unarmed rather than fight against my relatives, against my cousins. And Mahabharata, if some of you know, it's a fight between the cousin brothers, between the 5 Pandavas and the Kauravas, which are 100. So immediately a few verses later, chapter number 2, verse number 2, Shri Krishna, he says that, O Arjun, how could you be so unpure? How could you be so impotent? I don't want to fight. And if you fight, you will go to the heavenly planets. That means go to Jannah. Bhagavad Gita chapter 2 verse number 31 says, blessed are those Kshatriya who have the opportunity to fight. And if you fight, you shall go to Jannah. And many a times, there are critics of Islam who pick up certain verses from the Quran, certain hadith, and they try to malign Islam. And one of the common hadith which the critics of Islam use and the media uses is from Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, volume number 4, in the book of Jihad, chapter number 2, hadith 45, which says that our beloved Prophet Muhammad said that if a mujahid goes to the battlefield, and if he's killed, he will go to Jannah. And if he comes back alive, he'll get the booty of this world. He'll get the wealth of this world. And if you read Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 37, Shri Krishna says, Arjun, that, O Arjun, go and fight. And if you're killed, you will go to the heaven. And if you come back alive, you'll get the wealth of this world. Verbatim, what Sahih Bukhari says, is also mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. So I tell the Hindus, you have not read your scriptures. So why do you have double standards? So we Muslims, unfortunately, we don't read the Quran with understanding. Allah says, Ta'alu ila kalimatin sawa'in bayna baynakum. Come to common terms as been assigned you. Which is the first term? Allah na'budu illallah. That we worship none but Allah. So we have to convey the message of Islam by coming to common terms. And believe me, if you use this strategy of the Quran of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, believe me, you will have success. The fourth strategy used by the media is, they say things about Islam which are alien to Islam. For example, Islam degrades the woman. Islam does not give rights to women. In fact, Islam is the religion which has the maximum rights for the woman. They say that Islam is an illogical religion. In fact, Islam is the most logical religion. They say Islam is unscientific. In fact, Islam is the only religion which does not go against established scientific facts. The fifth strategy used by the media is that, as I mentioned earlier, that they have double standards. If any Muslim does a mistake, they blame it on the religion. If a non-Muslim does a mistake, they don't blame it on the religion. Why? Today, if I ask you the question, which human being in the history of humanity has killed the maximum human beings in the world? Can you guess? Hitler, very easy. You don't get a reward for that, very easy. Hitler, who was he? Was he a Muslim? He was a Christian. Did you go to madrasa?
No.
So that time they will not say that Christianity advises that it should kill 6 million Jews. Why? Today when the Western world is talking about, you know, Muslim terrorist. If you go to UK, you might have heard of IRA, Irish Republican Army. Irish Republican Army, it's a Catholic terrorist group. It is basically different between Catholics and the Protestants. It is 100% on religion. Yet, no one calls them as Christian terrorist or Catholic terrorist. They are called as Irish terrorist. Why? LTTE, no, they're not there. Liberation Tamil Tigers, Elam. They're Christians, they're Hindus, but they're called as Tamil Tigers. You know, today, the maximum killing done in India is by whom? It's by the Maoist, the communist. ULFA, the Hindu organization, the main purpose is to attack the Muslims. But they never call as Hindu terrorist. Why? Something happened in Kashmir, the media says Muslim terrorists have done the killing. Why? So this is the strategy of the media. They have double standards. You know, if a 50-year-old Arab comes to India and comes to Hyderabad and marries an 18-year-old girl, it will come headlines. 50-year-old Muslim marries an 18-year-old girl. When a 50-year-old non-Muslim rapes a 6-year-old girl, it comes in news briefs. Why? So these are the double standards of the media. And one of the strategies used by the media is that they do mention things which are correct in Islam, which are part of the Quran and Sunnah, but they say that these things are the problem for humanity. And I'd given the talk on Islam, the solution for humanity. And what they say is the problem for humanity actually is the only solution for humanity. And this we discuss when we have our annual peace conference in Bombay by the title Peace, meaning Islam, the solution for humanity. And today, Muslims, they're labeled as fundamentalist. What is the meaning of the word fundamentalist? Fundamentalist, by definition, means a person who follows the fundamentals of one particular subject. For example, if a person wants to be a good mathematician, he should know, follow, and practice the fundamentals of maths. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of maths, he cannot be a good mathematician. For a person to be a good scientist, he should know, follow, and practice the fundamentals of science. Unless he is a fundamentalist in the field of science, he cannot be a good scientist. You can't paint all fundamentalists with the same brush, that all are good or all are bad. Depending in which field, depending upon in which subject the person is a fundamentalist, you have to label him accordingly. For example, if you have a fundamentalist robber whose profession is to rob, he's bad for the society. On the other hand, if you have a fundamentalist doctor whose profession is to save human lives, he's good for the society. So you can't paint all fundamentalists with the same brush. Depending in which field, in which subject the person is a fundamentalist, you label him accordingly. As far as I am concerned, I am a fundamentalist Muslim and I am proud to be a fundamentalist Muslim. Because I know, I follow, and I strive to implement the fundamentals of Islam. And I know that there is not a single fundamental of Islam which is against humanity as a whole. There may be a couple of fundamentals of Islam because of lack of knowledge. The non-Muslim may think it is against humanity. But the moment you give the background and the logical reason, there is not a single fundamental of Islam which anyone can point out which is against humanity as a whole. When we read the Webster dictionary, it says that fundamentalism was a movement which first started in the early part of the 20th century by a group of Protestant Christians. These Protestant Christians, they protested against the church. The church initially believed that the message of the Bible was from God. These Protestant Christians, they said that not only is the message of the Bible from God, every word, every letter of the Bible is from God. If someone can prove that every word, every letter of the Bible from God is from God, then this movement is a good movement. On the other hand, if someone can prove that every word of the Bible, every letter of the Bible is not from God, then this movement is not a good movement. When we read the Oxford Dictionary, it says, when we read the definition, it says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of any scriptures. The teachings of the ancient scriptures of any religion. Fundamental by definition means, according to Oxford Dictionary, a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of the scripture of any religion. But when we read the revised edition of the Oxford Dictionary, there's a slight change in the definition. It says that fundamentalist is a person who strictly adheres to the ancient teachings of the scriptures of any religion, especially Islam. Especially Islam has been added in the definition of the revised edition of the Oxford Dictionary. The moment you hear the word fundamentalist, you start thinking of a Muslim. So what initially the word fundamentalism was used for the Christians, today it is used for the Muslims. Holy war was used for the Crusaders, today is used at jihad. This is media. The moment you hear the word fundamentalist, start thinking of a Muslim, start thinking of an extremist. And we Muslims, we apologetic. No, I'm not a fundamentalist. We go on the back foot. No, I'm not an extremist. I tell the world that I am an extremist. I'm extremely kind, I'm extremely merciful, I'm extremely loving, I'm extremely honest, I'm extremely just. What's wrong in being extremely kind, extremely merciful, extremely honest, extremely just? Can anyone tell me, can any human being point out to me that why should I not be extremely honest and extremely just? You can't be partly honest when it benefits you, you're honest. When it does not benefit you, you're not honest. And that's what the Quran says. Quran says you should be extremely just, extremely honest, extremely kind. We should be extremist in the right direction. Extremist as far as the teachings of the Quran are concerned, as far as the teachings of the last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam are concerned. We should not be extremist in the wrong direction. Today, the media, they label Muslims as terrorists. And a very common statement used to come in the media a few years back, which said that every Muslim is not a terrorist, but every terrorist is a Muslim. And the reply to this statement is given by me in my lecture, Is Terrorism a Muslim Monopoly? Time does not permit me to go into detail. In that lecture of mine, Is Terrorism a Muslim Monopoly? I've done a postmortem of this statement and I've given the details. But today, the Muslims are looked upon as though they're terrorists. What is the definition? What is the meaning of the word terrorist? Terrorist by definition means a person who causes terror. For example, if a criminal sees a policeman, he's terrified. So for the criminal, the police is a terrorist. In this context, every Muslim should be a terrorist. Whenever a criminal sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Whenever any rapist sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Whenever any robber sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Whenever any anti-social element sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. I'm aware that the word terrorist is more commonly used for a person who terrorizes an innocent human being. In this context, no Muslim should ever terrorize any innocent human being. And for this definition, just about 2 months back, the UK government has banned me. Because I said that every Muslim should terrorize the antisocial element. And we should not terrorize any innocent human being. We find today that many a times, two different labels are used for the same person, for the same activity. For example, when India, about 60, 70 years back, when they were ruled by the British government, there were many Indians who were fighting for the freedom. These Indians, by the common Indians, they were called as freedom fighters, as patriots. But the same people, same activity, by the Britishers, they were labeled as terrorists. Same people, same activity, two different views, two different labels. If you agree with the view of the British government that they had a right to rule over India, then you have to call these people as terrorists. But if you agree with the view of the common Indians that the Britishers came to India to do business, they have no right to rule over us, then you would call these people as freedom fighters, as patriots. Same people, same activity, but two different labels. You can give several such examples in world history. We know in 1875, the American Revolution took place. At that time, when the Britishers were ruling USA, according to the Britishers that time, George Washington was terrorist number one. Later on, when USA gets its freedom, George Washington becomes the president of USA. Imagine, terrorist number one of the world at that time becomes the president of USA. So what we come to know, that whoever is in power, whatever label they give, it gets stuck onto it, irrespective whether it's right or wrong. So this is the power of the media. Therefore, I said, media is the most important weapon today. Right or wrong is secondary. It may be right, may be wrong. We have the example of South Africa. Previously, before South Africa got its freedom, when it was ruled by the white apartheid government, the white apartheid government had imprisoned Nelson Mandela, called him the biggest terrorist, and imprisoned him in Robben Island for more than 25 years. When South Africa gets its freedom, Nelson Mandela is released, and he becomes the president of South Africa. And later on, he gets the Nobel Prize for Peace. Imagine, terrorist, of biggest terrorist of the world at that time, gets the Nobel Prize for Peace. Not that he was good and then he became peaceful. For the same activity for which he was imprisoned for 25 years and called a terrorist, for the same activity, a few years later, he gets the Nobel Prize for Peace. So from this we learn that whoever is in power, whatever label that person in power gives, it gets stuck onto the individual. This is the power of media. And unfortunately, we Muslims, as far as media is concerned, we're very backward, and we'll come to it later on. The seventh strategy used by the media is to malign Islam, that when they find any good Muslims who have done good work for humanity, for social cause, they will not highlight his identity as a Muslim. And you have example in history. You know, I was in school. I had learnt in science. The Aristotle of the East was Avicenna. And Avicenna sounds like a, you know, European name, Avicenna. It is Ali ibn Sina. Avicenna. We had learnt the father of chemistry was Geber. You know Geber? Geber sounds like a Western name. It is Jabir ibn Hayyan. Jabir ibn Hayyan is the father of chemistry. In school we learn Geber. So this is how does the media work? No, even if a Muslim hears the word Geber, we are Geber, some non-Muslim, some Westerner. It is Jabir ibn Hayyan. And on the other hand, strategy number 8. If there is a Muslim who speaks against Islam, against the Quran, or against the Prophet, they highlight them out of proportion. Example, Salman Rushdie. Example, Taslima Nasri. So you know it, you all are, mashallah, well versed with the media. You all hear the media, but you don't know you're getting programmed by the media. So these are various strategies used by the media to fulfill the agenda of war on the religion of peace. If we analyze the four strategies that are used, the four different methods, categories of media, this article that came on the 16th of April, 1979, in the Newsweek magazine, it said that in a span of 150 years, from 1800 to 1950, more than 60,000 books have been written against Islam. If you do a calculation, more than one book was written against Islam in a span of 150 years. More than one book every day. And after 9/11, this has reached epidemic levels. Every day, several books are written against Islam. And one of the common message spread by these books, especially after 9/11, is that Islam was spread by the sword. Peace, if you translate Islam, peace was spread by the sword. It sounds ironical, difficult to digest. And if you know history, we learn from history that the Arabs, the Muslims, they ruled the Arab land for about 1400 years. For a few years, the Britishers came. For the few years, the French came. But as a whole, the Muslims, Arabs, they were the lord of the Arab lands. Yet today, there are 14 million Arabs who are Coptic Christians. These 14 million Coptic Christians, they are giving Shahada, they are bearing witness that Islam was inspired by the sword. We Muslim ruled Spain for over 800 years. We didn't do the job. When the Crusaders came, there was not a single Muslim who could openly give the azan. We Muslims, we didn't do the job. We didn't deliver the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the reason we suffered. In India, the Muslims, we ruled for about 1,000 years. Today, more than 80% of the Indians, they're non-Muslims, they're Hindus. These 80% non-Muslim Indians, if we wanted at that time, if we wanted, we could have converted every non-Muslim at the point of the sword. We had the power. We didn't do it. Today, these more than 80% non-Muslim Indians, they are giving shahada. They are bearing witness that Islam was inspired by the sword. This is a living example. If the Mughals, if the Muslims wanted, they could have converted each and every non-Muslim Indian at the point of the sword. They didn't do it because it's not allowed in Islam. Today, the country which has the maximum number of Muslims, it's Indonesia. Which Muslim army went to Indonesia? Which Muslim army went to Malaysia, which has more than 50% Muslims? Which Muslim army went to the east coast of Africa? Which sword? Thomas Carlyle says, it is the sword of the intellect. You have to first get the sword. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125. Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikma wal ma'azit al hasna wajadil billati ahsan. Invite all the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. It is talking about the sword of the intellect. It is the sword of intellect, the sword of peace, which is conquering the hearts. Therefore today, if we analyze that though we Muslims, we aren't doing our job, we aren't doing our duty of conveying the message which is compulsory on every Muslim. Unfortunately, we are behind. And if we see, we'll first discuss the print media. If you see on the other hand, the Christian missionaries, you know, I don't know the samples, they make beautiful posters. And if you show it to any Muslim, including the Arabs, they read as Allah Muhammad. And I've asked this to even a few Arabs. Arabic is the mother tongue. What is it, Sheikh? He said, Allah Muhammad. I said, read it correctly. He said, Allah Muhammad. It is actually Allah Muhabba. God is love. The way they write in calligraphy, they can even deceive an Arab. When we read Allah and meme, it automatically becomes Allah Muhammad. It is Allah Muhabba. God is love. It's a verse of the Bible that God is love and you dwell in love, so God will dwell in you. It's a verse of the Bible. They're catching fish. They're using deceit. Beautiful posters, four color. Very good paper. Other posters you'll find. If you read, Rabbana, so immediately Rabbana, Atina, Fid Dunya, it's automatic, you know. We go into the automatic mode. It is Abbana, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name in Arabic. And I've given the talk on deceit in Christian evangelism. And I can give you several examples because we are in touch with these Christian missionaries. And once there was an alim in our own organization who knows Arabic very well. And the beautiful calendar with Arabic calligraphy that came. He told me, please, Akhirbhai, can I have that calendar? I said, really, you want it? Yes, beautiful. Are you sure? Read it. I want it. I gave it to him. After 1 week, I called him. Where's the calendar? I said, it's on my wall. Thank you, Jazakallah. I said, get it back. He says, why? Get it back. He said, why? You have given it to me as a gift. I said, get it back. He gets it back to me, and I tell him, these are verses of the Bible. Very beautiful calligraphy in Arabic. To an Indian Pakistani, anything in Arabic we find on the ground, keep it in the pocket. Kalam Allah. Arabic means word of Allah. Put it in the pocket or keep it close. So when they see beautiful calligraphy, they don't bother what the message is. It is a snake in your house. This is deceit used by Christian missionaries, which we should not do at all. And if we sell these posters outside Haram, it will go for 10 riyals easily. We Muslims should not involve deceit at all, because haq will prevail. Haq is sufficient, as Allah says in the Quran. وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقَ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ قَانَ زَوْكَ. Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse 81. That when truth is heard against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. They are using new and new technique. Now they have come up something known as contextualization. You know, they have copies called as Kitab al-Muqaddas. You read, open, it starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Immediately, we think it's the Quran. It is the translation of the Bible into Arabic, known as contextualization. In Arabic, Kitab al-Muqaddas. In English, we have copies called as True Furqan. True Furqan means this is the correct Quran and that is the wrong Quran. The Bible is the Sahih Furqan, indicating that the Quran that you have is not Sahih. And they use verses Maryam alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam. And we may think, because we don't know the Quran well, if you read the translation, we'll start thinking it is the translation of the Quran. They're trying to catch fish. They're using deceit. We Muslims, as I mentioned, we are very backward as far as media is concerned. And especially Dawah, we haven't taken off the ground yet. For example, India, where I come from, mashallah, more than 1 billion people living, out of which 180 million Muslims safely, some say more than 200 million. We have Dawah magazines. Do you know the largest circulating Islamic magazine, what is the publication? You know how much? How much? It is 15,000 only. Islamic Voice, which was 15,000, now I'm told it's gone down to 9 to 10,000. So 15,000 also has come down. for the largest Dawa circulating magazine in English. It was 15,000, now it is maybe 9, 10 or 12,000, that's it. In USA, a couple of years back, I done a survey. Largest circulating Muslim magazine, 50,000. But more of an organization magazine. Dawa magazine, one of the good magazines which I consider to be the best. I consider Juma magazine to be one of the best Islamic magazines. What is the circulation? Only 15,000. Now they've expanded maybe a couple of good magazines. What is the number? 15,000. Now it may have gone to a couple of few thousand more. If you compare to the Christian missionary, there is a sect of Christianity, an outcast, known as Jehovah's Witnesses. They don't consider themselves to be the mainstream Christians. Majority of the Christians, they don't consider them to be Christians. They publish a magazine by the name of Watchtower. Watchtower. Can you guess what is the number they print? Can you guess? How much? Million. Billion. How much? MashaAllah. That means all are watching Peace TV. Good. This question when I asked several times before, the answer used to be 10,000, some 50,000, 100,000. Maximum I got was 200,000 in all my just past 2 years, before 2 years. I never got a reply from any Muslim of more than 200,000. Leave us at print, we Muslims can't even think. Anyway, do you know the exact figure now? Million, million. Tell me the exact figure now. How many million? Sita. Fine, the figure that you see on the Peace TV, what I mentioned in 2005, it was 20.83 million. But 2 years back, it was 37.1 million. Watchtower is a magazine printed by Jehovah's Witnesses. Four color job. 37.1 million every fortnight in 169 languages. 169 languages, 37.1 million. I'm sorry, it's a 1.5-year-old statistics. Surely they might have gone more than 40 million now. 37.1 million in 2008, October. Fortnightly, if you multiply by 2 monthly, it comes to 74.2 million in 2008 in 169 languages. The same organization, the same group, Jehovah's Witnesses, print another magazine, Awake, which is a monthly magazine, 35.75 million in 81 languages. Both put together, monthly comes to 110 million. Jehovah's Witnesses, an outcast, a sect which is not considered to be the mainstream of Christianity. They distribute free. Maybe some places 2 rupees. 2 rupees means 15 fills. Namesake, you know. Four color job. What are the Muslims doing? It puts us to shame. Leave aside print, we can't even think. You compare these Christian missionaries. Our religion is supposed to be a religion of missionaries, religion of da'is. We aren't doing our job. You know, these missionaries, they have organizations. I'll give you the example of Jimmy Swaggart. Surely those of you who, many of you may be aware of Sheikh Ahmed Didat, and one of his very good debates was with Jimmy Swaggart. Jimmy Swaggart at that time in 1980s, you know, he had a budget of $400 million a year, more than $1 million a day, only to keep his head above water. What was his expenditure? More than $1 million a day, only to keep his head above water. Today, there are umpteen number of American organizations only localized in one state of USA, and the budget is $500 million, $450 million, $600 million. I can give you a list of tens of numbers of organizations, Christian Dawah organization, whose budget is more than $1 million a day. I don't know of any Muslim organization, Dawah organization that I know of, any private Dawah organization which even has $1 million a month budget. And I've traveled, mashallah, length and breadth of the world. I've interacted with the top Dawah organization. I don't know of any Dawah organization which even has $1 million a month budget. Leave us at $1 million a day. Not that Muslims don't have the money. Allah has given us the black gold. We have the money. We don't know where to spend it. Yeah, we may spend on shopping. Number one, 20 million pounds in one day shopping. Headlines, Muslim. Went for a weekend holiday and spent $30 million. Comes in news. You know these Christian missionaries? One type of dawah is giving public speaking. They have organizations where they train people how to do public speaking. How to modulate, how to speak. Unfortunately, I hardly know of any Muslim organizations which train the duat in how to deliver talks. Today, scientific research tells us that when a person gives a public talk, the matter he speaks carries only 7% weightage. How much? 7% only. 93% is presentation skills. How do you modulate your voice? Eye to eye contact, gestures. All these are presentation skills. How do you stand? How do you move your hand? How do you increase your volume? How do you decrease? What's the distance from the microphone? All these are specialized techniques. In Christian missionaries, they train the duats. They're missionaries. Unfortunately, in the Muslim world, I hardly know of any organizations which train the duat in public speaking. We in Bombay, we have annual sessions we have, where we get people from different parts of the world, from USA, from Canada, from Singapore, from Malaysia, different parts. And we give them training. We only select about 20, and train them in a span of about 40 days, the techniques of public speaking. And that is the reason you'll find that I never keep a podium, not that my physique is very good, but they call body language. Even your body speaks. Even your eye speaks. If I find someone is talking and if I stare at him while talking, he'll understand I'm telling him, shut up. I can't stop my lecture and say, please, brother, shut up. So these are all techniques of public speaking. How well you convey your message. This is part of the media. As far as the other media is concerned, the internet, the information technology. You go on the internet. Initially, when internet was there, there were hardly any Islamic websites. What information you found, majority was against Islam, done by the Christian missionaries. Now, when you go on the site, we have many Islamic websites, but yet a greater number of anti-Islamic sites. And unfortunately, as far as conveying the message on information technology platform, we Muslims are backward. We are very backward. The way they, and now, believe me, to attack Islam is very easy. You go on the internet or any of these websites, type 30 grammatical errors in the Quran. And believe me, if you ask a common Arab, it's my challenge. 90% won't be able to reply, 90% of the Arabs. And I've done that, unless he's a great scholar. Not that the person asking knows. These are all written by Arabic great scholars of the past, that how beautiful the Quranic Arabic is, and give examples, which now these Christian missionaries read the scholars of the Muslims, and they attack the Muslims today, because our Arabic is not that well-versed. Even a normal colloquial Arab, he will not be able to reply to more than 90% of the grammatical errors of the Quran. They are not grammatical errors, that is the superiority of the language of the Quran. You go on the internet, 100 scientific errors in the Quran. And believe me, if you go to a normal Muslim who's even read a lot about Islam, he may not be able to answer more than 90%. So to attack Islam has become so easy. all these allegations, none of them are true. But we unfortunately have not made these answers popular. The way they are attacking Islam at a great speed, we are way behind. And the most important category of media today, according to me, it is the television media. Television media today, satellite, is the most important of all the media. Today, research tells us there are more than 20,000 satellite channels. An investment of more than $400 billion. $400 billion has been pumped into the media today. Unfortunately, 99% of this is haram. Haram entertainment, haram education, haram. You'll hardly find less than 1% which you can say halal. And we Muslims, as far as Dawah is concerned on the media, is way behind. Yes, I know many Muslims who own entertainment channels with a big budget. But unfortunately, our Islamic satellite channels, if you compare to the Christian missionaries, only in USA alone, there are more than 100 Christian missionary channels. In USA alone. In UK alone, you'll find another 100. In Europe, all put together, 700 Muslims. The first one we started was in 1998, when they already had more than 50 channels, Christian missionary. We started with the first one, that's Iqra. Before that, it was the MTVA, Muslim TV Ahmadiyya, which is again a diversion. And now, alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah, the Muslims have woken up. And now, according to my knowledge, there are about somewhere close to 90 Islamic channels, out of which more than 65 are Arabic, 10 are Urdu, 3 are English, few Turkish, approximately close to 90 channels. But the unfortunate part of it is, these 90 channels, their viewership is so less. It is pathetic. Most of the Arabic channels, hardly a couple of them touch more than 1 million viewers. 65 Arabic channels, just a couple of few may be touching more than 1 million viewers. And those that touch 1 million viewers also, 3 million, 4 million, not more than that. If you compare to God TV, you know God TV? God TV is the most popular Christian missionary satellite channel. It is based in UK and uplink from Israel. They're on 15 satellite channels. They're on 15 satellites, you know, 15 satellites. I don't know any Muslim satellite channel which is on more than 5 satellites besides Peace TV. I don't know of any. 15. And their potential viewers. There's something like actual viewers, there's something like potential viewers. Potential viewers means in how many houses does that channel reach, whether they see or not is separate. God TV has more than 500 million. More than 500 million potential viewers. Actual viewers, maybe less than 100 million. And most of the Islamic channels, none of these channels are Dawah-oriented channels. These channels are not specialized in conveying the message to the non-Muslims. They're more specialized in Islam-based, which is important. Giving the Muslims more information about Islam, which is important and good. Some channels may have a very small portion of it dedicated to Dawah, very small portion. What we require, channels which are based mainly in removing the misconceptions of the non-Muslims, in conveying the message of Islam to the non-Muslims. And with this intention, Alhamdulillah, when we started the organization, we have to first produce programs for the other satellites. We gave programs on the cable TV in Bombay. At that time in the 90s, the only city in the world which had 1 million viewers of 3 hours hardcore dawa was Bombay. In the 90s. More than 1 million viewers. Only in Bombay by cable TV network. With this small thing, we started, mashallah. With the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the year 2005, towards the end of December, we had the launch of the Peace TV, which is regular programming started in January 2006, about more than 4.5 years back. And alhamdulillah, when we started this channel, Peace TV, my main aim was not to compete with the other Islamic channels. I always believe in putting my standards high. My main aim that time was to increase the viewership more than God TV. And the God TV's budget is phenomenal. It's phenomenal. We can't think of that. But Allah's help was with us. And alhamdulillah, by the end of 2009 and the beginning of 2010, now, mashallah, Peace TV has a bigger viewership even than God TV, mashallah. Though our budget may be less than 10% of the budget, much less than 10% of the budget, but the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. And the viewership of today of Peace TV is more than 100 million viewers. Potential viewer, maybe 3/4 billion. I'm talking about actual viewers. Viewers means those who watch Peace TV, whether every day, whether a few times a week. It is alhamdulillah more than 100 million throughout the world. And with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are trying our level best to at least be a witness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the day of judgment, we can say, at least we conveyed the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to 100 million people. You know, maybe approximately a couple of percentage of the world. We have done our job. But the point to be noted is that unfortunately, we Muslims, we don't believe in professionalism. I know many Muslims who own channels, entertainment channels, haram, and even Islamic channel. The budget for Islamic channel, $2 million a year, $3 million a year. For the entertainment haram channel, $40 million a year. Why? $50 million a year. Not that Muslims don't have the money. For the haram channel, we can spend $40, $50 million a year. Islamic channel, $2 million a year. Why? The unfortunate part of it is that we don't believe in professionalism. We do professionalism when it is business. We see a business office, top office, Italian marble, air conditioned, top. Islamic? You know, part-time, spare time. It should be the opposite. When we do anything for Islam, it should be top quality. In business, you can compromise. Unfortunately, we Muslims, when we do anything for Allah, we do part-time or spare time. No quality time. If you give your quality time for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you see the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala coming to you. That's the reason Muslim Ummah today, the state that we are in, we have the best deen, we have the best guidance of the Quran, we have the hidayah of the last and final messenger, but unfortunately, we have deviated from the Quran and Sunnah. If we go back to Quran and Sunnah, inshallah, we'll see that we will again be the torchbearers. What we require today, that since the topic of this talk, is media and Islam, war or peace. Islam, alhamdulillah, is a religion of peace. It's always for peace. Even if it does have to use force or war, the main intention is peace. Like how many a time the police uses violence to let peace prevail in that city or that country. So Islam gives permission as a last resort sometimes to use force to let peace prevail. Main intention is peace. Islam is always for peace. Unfortunately, the media today, the media, it is at war with peace. What we have to do, as I told you today, media is the most important weapon. Unfortunately, this weapon is used more for haram activities rather than halal activities. We have to turn the tables over. We have to use this media for the halal activity. Use it for the spread of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And see to it that you give your quality time, your quality product. And then you will see that inshallah, inshallah, however much the non-Muslim don't like it. And you see today that the more the media is trying to attack Islam, Islam is growing. Not because we're doing our job. After 9/11, the media started attacking Islam more. In USA alone, in a span of 10 months after 9/11, more than 32,000 non-Muslims accepted Islam. More than 32,000 Americans accepted Islam. In UK alone, according to Yuan Redley, in a span of 10 months, 20,000 Europeans accepted Islam. The more they're trying to attack Islam, the more Islam is spreading. The media is telling that Islam degrades the woman. Do you know, out of those non-Muslims accepting Islam, two-thirds of them are women. If Islam subjugates the woman, why are the American women accepting Islam? Why are the European women accepting Islam? Why? Because Islam has the solution to the problems of womankind. Islam has the solution to the problem of humankind. And it's a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, given in no less than three different places. In Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, verse number 33. In Surah Fatah, chapter number 48, verse number 29. In Surah Saf, chapter number 61, verse number 9, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِلُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُزِيرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. That he has sent his messenger with guidance and the religion of truth, so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, atheism, modernism, secularism. Islam is destined to supersede all. Kull, master them all. And Allah ends the message in two places. With وَقَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِدًا. In one place, that Allah is enough as a witness. And in two other places, Allah says, هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولُهُ بِالْهُدَى وَالدِّينِ الْحَقِّ لِيُزْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّهِ. That Allah has sent his messenger with guidance and the religion of truth, so that it will prevail over all the other religions, over all the other isms, whether it be Christianism, Judaism, Hinduism, secularism, modernism, Marxism, communism. Islam is destined to supersede all. Kull, master them all. وَلَوْ قَالَ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. However much the mushrik don't like it, Allah has given a promise. This deen of his will prevail with or without you, with or without me, the rubbish that we are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not require you and me to make his deen prevail. If we think that if I do da'wah, then Islam will spread, I'm the biggest fool in the world. Allah does not require you and me the rubbish that we are. Allah is giving us an opportunity to make hay while the sun is shining. Do a prophet's job and earn a prophet's reward. I would like to end my talk by giving the quotation of Dr. Adam Pearson, who said that people who worry one day nuclear weaponry will fall in the hands of the Arabs, they fail to realize that the Islamic bomb, the bomb of peace, has already been dropped. It fell the day Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was born. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have mics set up at different points in the hall and outside. Those of you that have questions that you'd like to ask, I will now take questions after a brief pause. Please follow the protocol of the question asking. You know, we have microphones that we're passing around. Okay, Dr. Zakir will point to the person that he is choosing to answer. And then please, those of you who have the microphones can follow his direction. I think this is the simplest solution. Okay, Dr. Zakir will take it over.
I request that if a microphone stand can be put, one on the right side, one on the left side, one behind the lady, that becomes easier. To pass the microphone, we waste about 10, 20 seconds, that's precious, maybe 30 seconds. So if you can put a microphone on a stand here on my right, one on my left, one on the lady's side, and one maybe outside. And I request that please, as mentioned earlier, that please follow the rules and regulation. This is a question answer time, not a lecturing time. Please see to it that you give first an opportunity to the non-Muslims. If there are any non-Muslims in the audience, I would request the non-Muslims to first come up in the queue. We would give them the first chance. You can ask any questions. You may agree with me, you can disagree with me. For the non-Muslim, any question on Islam, on the topic, outside the topic, they are most welcome. You may agree with me, you may disagree with me. This is the opportunity. I request the non-Muslim brothers and sisters to come on the microphone. And whenever they come, I would request the volunteers that allow them to come in front of the queue. They are our guest of honors today. So give them the first opportunity. After the questions from the non-Muslims have been exhausted, inshallah, we'll entertain questions from the Muslim brothers and sisters. Please keep your questions brief. It should be in two or three sentences. If it is more than that, then it's a speech. The lecture time is over. This is a question answer time. Please keep your questions brief. For the Muslims, your questions should be only on the topic. Media and Islam, war or peace. For the non-Muslims, they can ask any questions on Islam and comparative religion. For the Muslims, please ask your questions on the topic only. Please mention your name as well as the profession. It will help me in answering the question. I request if there are any non-Muslims. Are there any non-Muslims in the audience? Yes, brother, most welcome. Any non-Muslims here, they can break the queue. I'd request a non-Muslim first to ask the question. Please mention your name as well as the profession. It will help me in answering the question. Yes, brother.
Good evening. My name is Glenn McKay. I'm an accountant here in Qatar. I just wanted to know that since, as you're aware, the West misunderstands a lot about Islam, what do you consider maybe the one or two key things that the West really needs to understand that it has misconceptions about?
The brother asked the question that what are the one or two things that the West should understand which are key things in order to understand Islam? As I mentioned in my speech, that we should not judge Islam based on what individual Muslims do or what the Muslim society does. It should be based on the authentic sources. That is the glorious Quran and the authentic Hadith, the sayings of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. What the West should understand, that Islam is a religion of peace. And if you read in context, they should not pick up verses from the Quran out of context. In context, if you realize, it is the most peaceful religion. And whenever the Western world, when they try and attack the Quran or the Hadith, they should have a look at the other scriptures also. So when you're trying to attack the Quran, you fail to realize that similar things are mentioned in the Bible. Similar things are mentioned in the other scriptures. And not that everything is same. But the reason is so that you understand in what context it is used. So when the Western society agrees that as a last resort, all the Western countries, they have a police force, right or wrong? They have a police. The aim of the police is to maintain peace. Anyone who does not follow the law, does not follow the law of the country, the police may have to use force or violence to let peace maintain. Similarly, in Islam, peace is the main objective. It is against fighting. It is against violence. But it does give permission as a last resort for maintaining peace. Those people who break the laws of our Creator, who want to disrupt peace, Islam does give permission as a last resort, which is but natural, as you see law of most of the countries of the world. So why do the Western countries have double standards? So if they come to common terms and understand, they will understand Islam better. And to understand Islam, they have to go and read the Quran and the authentic sayings of the Prophet, not look at individual Muslims or Muslim society. Hope that answers the question.
Yeah, assalamu alaikum to all.
Walaikum
and
salam.
A very good evening. I am a non-Muslim and I am from India and I am in sales professional. Actually, first of all, I will give a lot of thanks to Mr. Jakir and all the organizers and sponsors who clarify many doubts in front of me. Actually, I just want to put a question. Where any religion give an authority to prove superior to us that Hindu is better than Muslims or Christian is better than Muslims? Yeah, I have just a question here.
Can you repeat the question? I heard the question that Hindu superior to Muslim, but I didn't hear it.
Yeah, actually, I just want to put a question. Any religion gives an authority to their followers that they should prove that their religion is more better than other religions.
Okay. That's a very good question. That does any religion give authority for it to claim that their religion is better than the other religion? The point to be noted is that we believe that Almighty God is only one God. He is the creator of all the human beings. He is the creator of Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Jew, everyone. We don't consider the God of the Hindu is different than the God of the Muslims, and the God for all the human beings is the same. And Almighty God meant only one religion to be followed, and that religion is submitting our will to God. We believe that Almighty God, all the messengers that came, preached one and the same message that we should submit our will to Almighty God. Muslim is not by name, Zakir, Muhammad, Sultan, Shakir, Abdullah. Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. As far as you mentioned about the word Hindu, Hindu is a geographical definition meaning a person who lives in the land of the Indus. Anyone who is in India, geographically, is called a Hindu. I come from India, so geographically, I'm a Hindu. Geographically, I'm a Hindu. But if you mean, no, Hindu is a person who does idol worship, then I'm not a Hindu. So Hindu actually is a word given by the Arabs when they came to India. You know, Hindi, Hindi. Now also when I go, they call me Hindi. So Hindi is a word used by the Persians and the Arabs when they came to India. It's a geographical definition for the people living in the land of India. So geographically, I'm a Hindu. This word Hindu does not exist anywhere in the Hindu scriptures before the 8th century. Before the Arabs came to India, nowhere in any of the Hindu scriptures will you find the word Hindu. It came by the Arabs when they came to India. The right word should be Vedantist, because they follow the Vedas. As far as the question is concerned, that does any religion give right for anyone to say that their religion is superior? I have done a study of all the scriptures, Hinduism, Christianity, Islam, Judaism. I have not come across any scripture besides the Quran which says that only their religion is correct. But Quran explicitly says, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 19, Inna Dina in the Lal Islam. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Almighty God is the religion of submitting our will to God. The Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter number 3, verse number 85. Surah Al-Imran chapter 3, verse 85. Allah says that if anyone chooses a religion other than Islam, other than submitting his will to God, it will never be accepted of him. And in the Akhirah, he will be amongst the losers. In the hereafter, he'll be among the losers. So Quran is the only religious scripture on the face of the earth which mentions it very clearly, unambiguously, without any doubt, that the only way of life, the only religion to follow is to submit our will to God. This statement you won't find in the Bible, you won't find in the Veda, you won't find in the Gita, you won't find in Ramayana, you won't find in the Talmud. But here again I'm saying, Islam means peace acquired by submitting our will to God. It doesn't mean that an Arab is superior to a non-Arab, or a black is superior to a white, or a white is superior to a black. The only way a human being can be superior to the other is by taqwa, is by God consciousness, is by piety, is by righteousness. Islam doesn't believe that one race is superior to the other, one group of people is superior to the other, except on the criteria of taqwa, that is piety, that is righteousness, that is God consciousness. So only way one human being can be superior to other is by God consciousness. So the religion to be followed is submitting your will to Almighty God. And it is very clear on that. And the guidance of Almighty God, our Creator, is given in the last and final revelation, the Quran, and last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And this thing is mentioned in all the scriptures. You read the Bible. Bible prophesizes the coming of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad. In the Old Testament, in the New Testament, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 18. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 18, verse number 19. In the Song of Solomon, chapter number 5, verse number 16. In the book of Isaiah, chapter number 12, verse number 29. If you read the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 16. In the Gospel of John, chapter number 15, verse number 26. In the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 11. In the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 7. All these are mentions about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come. And it's mentioned Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that he hears shall he speak. He shall glorify me. Now, these prophecies are talking about the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if you have to be a good Christian, you have to follow the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, or that you cannot be a good Christian. Same if you read the Hindu scriptures, if you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhaita 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, speak about Prophet Muhammad to come, peace be upon him. Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhaita 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, talk about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read the Kuntap Suktas, Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 124, verse number 1 to 14, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come. If you read Yajur Ved, chapter number 20, verse number 6, talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It talks about the Kalki Avatar. Kalki Avatar is the messenger to come in Kali Yuga. It says his father's name will be Vishnu Yas. Vishnu means God, Yas means servant, servant of God means Abdullah. Mother's name will be Sumati, meaning serenity, peaceful, means Amena. The same parents of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He'll be born in the village of peace, that is Makkah. He will have four companions talking about the four Khulafa Rashideen. He'll be given the first revelation in a cave, talking about Gare Hira. He will go northwards then come back. He will migrate northwards then come back. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went to Medina and came back. So all these are talking about the prophecy about Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So if you are a good Hindu, if you follow your scriptures, you have to believe in the last and final avatar, the last and final messenger, that's Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I can give you more than 100 references mentioned in the Hindu scriptures and the Vedas talking about Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So if you're a good Hindu, you should follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you're a good Jew, you should follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. If you're a practicing Christian, follow Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So that's the reason it's very clear cut in the Quran that the last and final revelation is the Quran and the last and final message of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Brother, I'd like to ask you that you said you're a Hindu, I believe, and you said that I would like to ask you that would you like Do you believe in the last and final messenger which is mentioned in your scripture? Do you believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam?
Yeah, sure.
Do you believe in him?
Yeah.
Do you believe there's one God? Do you believe that idol worship is wrong?
No.
Do you believe idol worship is wrong or right?
It is right.
You believe idol worship is right. Now, if you read your scriptures, it's mentioned in Svetasvata Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse 19. Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. Now, Pratima is a Sanskrit word which means an image. It means a photograph, a painting, a picture, a sculpture, a statue, an idol. It says, Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no painting, there is no picture, there is no sculpture, there is no idol. The same message repeated in Yajurveda, chapter number 32, verse number 3. Natasya Pratima Asti. Of that God, there is no Pratima. Almighty God has got no image, has got no photograph, has got no painting, has got no picture, has got no sculpture, has got no idol, has got no statue. So this Veda is the highest scripture of the Hindus. Do you know Vedas? Veda is the highest scripture.
Yes, sir.
So in Yajurveda, it's clearly mentioned that idol worship is prohibited. That's the reason if you go to certain scholars of Hinduism, they don't do idol worship. So I'm asking the question, if you are a good Hindu, then why do you follow idol worship?
Actually, it was already established by our ancestors.
Sorry?
It is already established by our ancestors and we are...
Correct. So if your ancestors say, you know, your ancestors also said the world is flat. Do you know that? Your ancestors and my ancestors also said the world is flat.
Yeah.
Do you believe the world is flat?
No.
Yes or no?
Yeah. I think that the world is flat.
You believe the world is flat?
Yeah.
Why?
Because once at a place, you if you will see the world and anything, that will directly come in front of you. If the world will be round, then certainly it can't come in a flat way and a straight way.
Sorry, I didn't hear you clearly. What do you say? Why do you believe the world is flat?
Yeah, sure.
No, why do you believe the world is flat? Have you gone to school?
Yeah, actually. Yeah, I was in school and I am a scholar of marketing.
You're a scholar of?
Marketing and sales.
Marketing, mashallah. So do you market when you show the world flat or you show it round?
Actually,
which product do you market?
Yeah, I am industrial product aggregates.
Sorry, marketing?
Industrial product aggregates.
Industrial product. So any time in marketing, have you spoken about the world? No.
No.
Not the world. No. So if you have to draw the world flat or round?
Actually, the world say that it is round.
It is round, na?
Yeah.
So why are you saying it is flat?
Because if we will put according to the science, we will see that if anything will be flat and if we will put any thing in front of us, then certainly it will come straight in front of us. So it's proved that the world is flat also.
No, the world is flat.
In that
temporarily, yes.
Yeah.
But overall, it is flat or round?
No.
Is it spherical or is it round?
Yeah.
Is it flat or spherical?
Overall, it is wrong, but in a contextual manner, we can also say that it is also flat.
No, perspective-wise, this is flat, fine.
Yeah.
In a subjective-wise, if you see a small portion, it appears to be flat.
Yeah.
But if you know science, and if you see a ship coming from the horizon, first you see the mask.
Yeah, mask, symbol, yeah.
Then you'll see slowly the ship coming. Why? Because it is?
Round.
Flat.
Round.
Sure. So do you believe the world is flat or round?
It is round.
Very good.
Yeah.
So do you agree with your grandfathers or not?
Yeah, we are agree.
Do you disagree with your ancestors or not?
We are agree.
Your ancestors said the world was flat.
No, not at all.
Don't believe, no?
Not agree. Yeah.
So what do you have to do if your ancestors are right, you believe in them. If your ancestors are wrong, you don't believe in them. So now when you came to know that your scriptures say that idol worship is prohibited, and I've given you references, from the Veda, from the Upanishad, talking about idol worship is prohibited. And if you see my debate between Shri Shri Ravi Shankar, have you heard of Shri Shri Ravi Shankar? You heard of him, na?
Yeah, I have also saw your video on YouTube.
Oh, you saw my video. Yeah. So there, even Shri Shri Ravi Shankar, when I spoke to him, and I convinced him that in your scripture, idol worship is prohibited. And he had no answer. That means he too agreed with the concept that idol worship is prohibited in Hinduism. So I'm asking the question, why are you yet following ancestors which are wrong?
Yeah, actually, it was basically taught by our ancestors and our parents. Yeah, that's why we are following.
So if your ancestors said the moon is made of cheese, will you believe in it?
Yeah. Up to a time, we will believe. But once we will be aware, after that, we will not follow.
So now are you aware?
Yes, sir.
Now you are aware that idol worship is wrong?
Partially.
So inshallah we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you do more research.
Yeah.
And you try and find out, and inshallah one day you'll be convinced that idol worship is wrong. And the day you get convinced idol worship is wrong, I will invite you to the religion of peace.
Okay?
Okay,
sir. Thank
Thanks
you.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
Dear brother,
are there any questions from the sister's side? Any sisters have any questions?
Yeah.
Are they non-Muslim than the sisters?
No, I'm a Muslim.
Are you non-Muslim?
No, I'm a Muslim. No.
If there's any non-Muslim among the sisters, they're most welcome to come on the microphone. They can even jump the queue. It'll be a pleasure to reply to any queries that they have. Any non-Muslim sisters? Please feel free to ask. This is the opportunity. It's not very common that you can ask any questions on Islam. And I love it. If you have any questions, you're most welcome, sister.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
If there's any question from the non-Muslim. Yeah, there are some non-Muslims here? In the genocide? Yes. If any non-Muslims among the brothers, they're most welcome to come on the queue in the front. Yes, brother. Is there a non-Muslim?
Hello. Doctor, there's a question from a gentleman who's a non-Muslim who's standing outside, and here this question is, why do you, Dr. Zakir, show always green color Quran in your speech? What is the relation between green color and Islam? Thank you. Gentleman's name is Suresh.
Non-Muslim brothers asked the question that why do you always show a green color Quran in my speeches? And what is the resemblance between green and Islam? Brother, the translation that I normally show in my talk is by Abdullah Yusuf Ali. It's the revised edition of Abdullah Yusuf Ali's translation printed in USA. So because I keep holding that translation, not that color is there, we have Quran in blue color, in red color, in various colors. So just because the translation, I prefer referring to one translation rather than changing when I use in my speeches, though I do read various different translations, but there's something like a photogenic memory. So when you keep on quoting, if you have the same print, then you come to know this verse is there on the second line on right-hand side. It's easier to remember. Therefore, I prefer using the one translation that is printed by the IIIT in USA. So that is, fortunately or unfortunately, it's in green color. So that's why you see the green Quran. Otherwise, you can have the Quran in any color, blue, black, red, there's no problem at all. Hope that answers the question, brother. Are you non-Muslims?
No, I am Muslim, but I'm asking on behalf of my friend. I'm asking on behalf of my friend who's
Let
Christian.
Your friend come right. Is there any non-Muslim like to ask a question directly? Any non-Muslims? If there are non-Muslims outside the tent, please allow them to come inside. If there are any asking questions, any non-Muslim would like to ask a question, we'd like to give them the opportunity first. Yes, brother, most welcome. I'd request the non-Muslim that please feel free. You can ask any question. You can even attack the Quran. No, attack Islam if you feel it is wrong, no problem. This is the opportunity. Inshallah, we'll try our level best to give you a reply. Yes, brother, most welcome.
Welcome, brother.
First of all, I want to thank you for giving me this chance. My name is, where can I get ye? My profession is teacher. I want to ask one question about Zakah. Zakah has different aims. One of the aim is supporting poor. But practically, I see when rich people are given different items. This is not a mistake. But the mistake is many company, they don't give the salary properly for their poor workers. So do you think that Zakah means taking money from the poor and giving to the rich. How do you evaluate this according to Quran? Thank you.
Brother asked the question that zakat means giving to the poor. And he finds that many of the companies, they don't give proper salary to the poor people. That means they're taking money from the poor and giving to the rich. Brother, as far as Islam is concerned, a Muslim should pay the proper wages to the worker. But always there bound to be difference of opinion. Normally it's human nature. A human being will never be satisfied with the salary he gets. A human being will never be satisfied with the salary he gets. If he gets 1,000 riyal, he would expect 2,000. If he gets 2,000, he'll expect 3,000. If he gets 3,000, he'll expect 10,000. Normally, a human being, generally, as a whole, is never satisfied. But as a Muslim, seeing the condition and the surrounding, he should pay proper wages as per the surrounding, as per the economical condition, he should pay a proper wage. It's not possible that an employer will be able to satisfy 100% of the employees. But every employee thinks that what my boss is paying me less. That's a psychology. Most of them, not all. So regarding your question, as far as the general trend is concerned, a Muslim is supposed to pay. That's the reason there is a contract. Before you start working, the employer will say, okay, fine, I'm going to pay you 5,000 riyals or 10,000 riyal. If you accept it, you like it, you work, otherwise you find some new job. So once he has made the contract, it becomes compulsory that he pays you your wages on time. On time, he can't delay it. But regarding whether he's paying you less or more, it is subjective. He should not pay you less, but what you think is less, he may think it's more. So depending upon the situation, a Muslim should pay a proper wages. Depending upon the work he's taking out, there cannot be differentiation. That this man, okay, fine, he's black, I'll pay him less, he's white, I'll pay him more. Which does happen in some society. It should be based on the work he's doing, not on the color of his skin. It can be based on the education qualification, no problem. Fine? So depending upon what work the person is doing, a Muslim is supposed to pay proper wages. And zakat means, it means to purify. Zakat means to increase. A Muslim is supposed to give zakat, that is 2.5% of his saving every lunar year in charity. So that his wealth increases, so that his wealth is purified. If someone is cheating someone and earning, he'll be responsible on the day of judgment and God will punish him. But normally he's supposed to work honestly, and whatever his excess saving is, 2.5% of his excess saving, you should give 2.5% of that every lunar in charity. Hope that answers the question. Are there any other non-Muslims? Are there any other non-Muslims? Any non-Muslims have any question? Any non-Muslim would like to ask a question? Non-Muslim among the sisters?
Yes.
Yes, sister, most welcome.
Salam alaikum wa rahmatullah. I never got a reply. Thank you. My concern was just that, first, I have...
Sorry, sister, I did not hear you. I only heard your salam. I said, walaikum salam.
Shukran. My concern was just that what I have come to know, that a Muslim can only marry a Jewish, first Islam Muslim, a Christian or a Jewish. What I know only the reason is that because they follow book, a holy book. I am a Hindu. I just wanted to know one thing, as you said before, that in Vedas it's written that you don't follow pratikya, you don't follow idol worship. As my parents also taught me, idol worship. But from my side, as I gained my consciousness, as I got to know about things, as I gained knowledge from the world, I personally don't believe in idol worship.
MashaAllah.
I go to a place where I peace, probably is but by the side of the sea. At the same time, it's not that I don't respect my God who is sitting up. It can be anyone without any form. So my question is that at the end of the day, when you say that we Hindus are supposed to follow Vedas, but not the idol worship. So at the end, we are following the holy book. That why Hindus have to convert, then if marry anyone who is Muslim.
Sister asked a very good question.
Thank you.
Firstly, she asked a question that she has two parts. First part that why are Muslims allowed to marry a Jewish or a Christian girl, but why not a Hindu girl? And I do agree that there are most of the scholars who say that a Muslim man can marry a Christian or a Jewish girl based on the verse of the Quran of Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 5, which says that lawful for you in marriage are the woman amongst the Ahle Kitab, that a girl who is a Jewish or a Christian, the verse of the Quran. But there's also a verse of the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 221, which says that it says that do not marry a mushrika, an idolatress, until she believes. A believing woman, a Muslima, a Momina, even if she's a slave woman, even if she's a bond woman, she's far superior than a mushrika, even if she allows you. Based on the verse of the Quran, a Muslim man is not allowed to marry any girl who does shirk. A girl who has faith is far superior than a girl who does shirk, even if she allows you. She may be the beauty queen. She may be the richest woman in the world. A believing woman who's ugly is far superior even to a girl who does idol worship and doesn't have iman. Now, based on these verses, there's one more verse in the Quran, in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 72, which says that they are doing kufr, those who say that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is God. Now, based on these three verses of the Quran, one verse says you can marry among the Ahle Kitab, the Jews and Christian. One verse says you should not marry a girl who does shirk. One more verse, Surah Maida, chapter 5, verse 72, says that among the Ahle Kitab, there are people who say that Jesus Christ is God. According to me, that is shirk. They are doing kufr. So isn't there a contradiction amongst the two, between the two verses? One verse says you should not marry a mushrik. One verse says you can marry Ahle Kitab. The third verse says among the Ahle Kitab, there are people who do shirk. So when we do more research in the Quran, you come to know, Quran says in Surah Imran, chapter 3, verse 110, that amongst the Ahle Kitab, min humul mu'minun awaqsum al-fasikun, among the Ahle Kitab, the Jews and Christian, some are mu'min, but the majority are perverted transgressors, they are fasik people. So according to me, I differ with the majority of the scholars who say that you can marry any Christian or Jewish girl. According to my research of the Quran, I believe that you can only marry those Christian and those Jewish girl who do not do shirk. Min humul mu'minun awaqsum al-fasikun. Amongst the Ahle Kitab, there are some who are mu'min, who are believing, who are believers, but the majority are perverted transgressors. So I believe you cannot marry any Christian who does shirk. Because Quran is clear-cut in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 221, you cannot marry a mushrika. The same thing is for a girl. A girl cannot marry a mushrik man until he believes. Similarly, coming back to your question, sister, that you said that you're a Hindu and you don't do shirk. So you're a Hindu and who does not do idol worship, then you will not be called a mushrika. But furthermore, as I mentioned earlier, sister, that if you are a good Hindu, besides not believing in shirk, besides not doing idol worship, you should even believe in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Sister, I'd like to ask you the question, that do you believe in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him?
I would just say that whosoever teaches the right, I believe in it.
Sorry?
Whosoever teaches the right teachings, I believe in it.
Fine. But it is also your duty to find out who's right, who's wrong.
I have no one to say who's right, who's
That's
wrong.
Right. But
I myself might not be right at any point
Fine.
Of time.
You may not be right, but your scriptures say that there is a Kalki avatar to come, whose father's name will be Abdullah, whose mother's name will be Amina. He'll be born in City of Peace. He will be a universal messenger. He will have four companions. All these things. He will get the revelation in Gara Hira. According to you, who does it imply? Who does it talk about? And when you do research in history, it is indicating to no one but the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So what we believe
I don't believe in it. I don't believe in getting married four times when you're happy with one.
Sorry, you don't believe in?
Getting married for four times.
No,
I know people.
I'm not asking you. Even I don't believe you can get married four times. Sister, the question is not marrying four times. The question is, do you believe in Prophet Muhammad? I'm not asking the question, do you believe marrying in four times? I never asked you that. I'm asking, do you believe in a scripture which speak about a messenger to come whose father's name is Abdullah, whose mother's name is Amina, who's got the revelation in Makkah? I'm not asking you for marriage. Will you ask a second question? I'll give you a second reply. But I'm asking the question that do you believe in the last and final messenger which is prophesied in the Hindu scriptures?
I do believe in Prophet Muhammad.
Mashallah.
However, I believe in the rest.
The rest? You have to believe. If you don't believe in the other messengers, you will not be a Muslim. The Quran is very clear cut. You have to believe in all the messengers of Prophet, all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right from Adam, peace be upon him, all that came down, Abraham, Noah, Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. Even if you reject one messenger, then you're not a Muslim. Muslim again, sister, is a person who submits his will to God, or a person who submits her will to God. It is not a label calling Zakir, Abdullah, or by the name Aisha, or Fatima, or Sultana. Muslima means a person who submits her will to the Creator Almighty God.
Thank you so much. That was the answer I have been looking for.
So if you submit your will to Almighty God, and if you believe there is one God, and you don't do idol worship, and you believe in the Prophet, Messenger, last and final Messenger, then in Arabic we say you are a person who has submitted your will to Almighty God. And regarding marriage, sister, what we believe, marriage is a sacred covenant. You can't believe in a vehicle which has got four tires. One tire is of a cycle and the other is of a truck. You know, then the vehicle won't run. That's the reason we believe that your life partner, who we believe in Quran, the Quran calls the wife as a muhsana. In the other scriptures, if you read the Hindu scripture, the Hindu scriptures call the woman as a sign of a devil. If you read Manusmriti, it says, you cannot trust a lady even if she's your mother. The Quran says, respect the womb that bore you. The Quran says that your wife is a muhsana, is a fortress against the devil. So unlike the other religions of Christianity and Hinduism, Quran uplifts the woman. It says that the woman is a muhsana, is a fortress against the devil, unlike the other religion. So if you read the Quran, sister, you will find that Quran uplifts the status of the woman and it gives women the due rights. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Thank you so much for that. At the end, I know is that if you don't follow idol worship, even if you're a Hindu, then you don't need to convert.
Sister, point number one. If you use the word convert, in Islam, every child is born in Dinul Fitr. According to a prophet, every child is born as a Muslim. Muslim, again, sister, means a person who submits his will to God. Later on, you are influenced by your elders, by your parents, by your teachers. You may start doing idol worship. You may start worshiping the fire. And that's the reason when a non-Muslim becomes a Muslim, the right word is not convert, it is revert. So what we believe that every human being, see, Muslim is a label which may not go down the throat of a non-Muslim. The right word is you should submit your will to Almighty God. If you believe there is one God, and you believe idol worship is wrong, and you believe Prophet Muhammad is a messenger, fine. You may not be a very good practicing Muslimah, fine. You may have some faults in practicing. For example, a person may be relaxed regarding the Salah. He may not do certain acts. But yet, if he believes there is one God, or if she believes there is one God, and she believes that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, so, generally, that person is called as a person who submits his will to God, or a person who submits the will to God. In Arabic, we say Muslim. Hope that answers the question. Like how I told you earlier, Hindu means a person who lives in India. By definition, I'm a Hindu. I was very open in saying that. Why? Because I know the definition. But if you say Hindu is a person who does idol worship, then I say I'm not a Hindu. So I'm an Indian Muslim. And if you translate Hindu Muslim, but yet I'm a person who believes in one God. I'm a person who submitted a will to Almighty God, and a person who believes in the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So, sister, do you believe in one God? Sister, do you believe in one God?
I believe there is one.
Do you believe idol worship is wrong?
I don't say it's wrong. If you're doing something from heart, even if you just by yourself meditating, or you yourself standing in front sculpture, or you yourself anywhere where there's no one around. If you're doing something from heart, with something not hurting someone else, I believe it's right.
No, you said you're doing something from your heart. If you do something from your heart, and you do something wrong,
not doing something wrong.
So say something from your heart.
Doing something wrong from heart.
What is right, what is wrong is subjective, sister. What is right for you may be wrong for me, and what is right for me may be wrong for you. So the basic criteria is, who knows what is right or wrong? For example, if you're sick, who do you go to? You go to a doctor, because you're not an expert in curing the illness. Similarly, we believe the expert of the human beings is our creator. So we have to follow the guidance of the creator. We can't say that I think robbing is right, therefore I'll rob. And believe me, no one can prove robbing is wrong to me, you know, if I argue. So just because I start thinking robbing is right, that does not mean I will start robbing. So therefore, we have to have someone who has supernal knowledge. What we believe, Almighty God is our creator. He is the one who has created us. He knows what is good, what is bad for us. And if you use your logic and scientific knowledge, we come to know that his teachings are based on reason and logic, and then we start having more faith in him. Hope that answers the question, sister.
It does. And I meant by not doing anything wrong in front of the Almighty God, not in front of any human being which has been created.
Correct. That's what we believe, that we mainly are here to submit our will to Almighty God, not to any human being.
True.
Except if he follows, if his teachings are following with the teachings of God, we agree with it. If his teachings go against the creator of God, we disagree with it. Hope that answers the question, sister.
True. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I have been looking forward for your all the uploads on YouTube. Today I couldn't attend your full session. Probably I will look forward to it now.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You're most welcome, sister.
Doctor, we have another question from a non-Muslim brother. His name is Ajit Nambia. He's a mechanical engineer, and I quote his question. The accused people in various terror attacks like the WTC, the Indian Parliament attack, etc., were Quran scholars, namely Muhammad Atta, Professor Jilani. You learned Quran and you teach peace, but they learned Quran and they spread terror. What is the difference? Also, why is there a large number of Muslim nations like Pakistan, Indonesia, etc., always in the terror, even though there is no Western influence in such countries? Thank you. I end quote.
Non-Muslim asked a question that there was an attack done on Parliament by Jilani, and I preach peace. How some Muslims preach, they practice violence, etc. But as far as Islam is concerned, as I mentioned earlier, Islam is a religion of peace. There may be certain Muslims, as I said, black sheep of the community, they may be misguided. I'm not referring to any particular person. I'm not blaming any particular person, because if I have to blame some person, I have to be sure that what is done is wrong. But generally, I do agree that there are certain Muslims who have been misguided by certain elements who take violence in the hand, which is totally against the Quran. Quran is very clear-cut in Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 32, which says that if anyone kills any other human being, whether it be Muslim or non-Muslim, it is as though, unless it be for murder, or for spreading mischief in the land, or spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. So if anyone kills any other innocent human being, the Quran says he has killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole human nation. So based on this verse of the Quran of Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse 32, killing any innocent human being is prohibited, it is haram. Anyone who does that, anyone who kills a single innocent human being, he is going against the Quran and he is not a practicing Muslim. What we see in the media, what the media portrays always is not correct. That Muslims are terrorists, Muslims are terrorists. Fine, there may be certain black sheep of a community. There may be certain Muslims who may be not following the Quran, and that's present in all the communities. What the media does is selectively picks up the black sheep of the Muslim community and portrays them as exemplary Muslim, which is wrong. In India, where you come from, and I believe the question is from India, maximum killing in India is done by the Maoist. Why doesn't the media, there may be a news, finish. They attack police stations. They are out of 600 districts of India, they have control over more than 150 districts. They have rocket launchers. And just an example, just a few months back, there was a bomb blast in the German bakery in Pune, the beginning of this year. And it said that 9 people killed in German bomb blast, suspect Muslim. Headlines. Same day, the Maoist killed 16 policemen. They know who the killer is. It comes in news briefs. Now, killing a policeman is a bigger crime than killing a civilian. 16 policemen confirmed who the person is. That comes in news briefs. Here they don't know who the person is, suspect. It comes as headlines. Why? This is how the media plays around. And finally, who they suspected, after a few months, we come to know that person didn't do it. You know, Bhatkali, Abdul Samad Bhatkali. It came when he was arrested, went to the High Court gave him bail. How can it be? So for so many days, Muslim suspect, Abdul Samad Bhatkal, finally they catch him. After a few months, turns out to be innocent. So this is how the media actually maligns Islam. But in short, any human being, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, kills any other innocent human being, Muslim or non-Muslim, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. It is totally wrong to kill any innocent human being. Hope that answers the question. Are there any other non-Muslims? Any non-Muslim sister? Any non-Muslim brother? Any non-Muslims have any questions? Any sister who's a non-Muslim like to ask a question? You're any non-Muslim brothers? Any non-Muslim brother? Sorry? Have all non-Muslims exhausted? If any non-Muslims like to ask a question, they're most welcome. This is the opportunity.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Arshia. I'm an architect. I left my job 2 years ago to learn Islam more perfectly, and also I'm knowing a Quran and I'm trying to learn the Quranic language. So my question is, like, I have many Christian friends and I want to spread the knowledge of Islam. When I told them to come with me to some seminar or somewhere, they politely avoids me. So what technique we should acquire to, you know, give them the dawah of Islam? Can you help me?
Sister, as far as dawah is concerned, there are techniques of doing dawah. One thing is having knowledge. Beside knowledge, you should also know how to initiate dawah. For example, a person may be a very good driver, but doesn't know how to start the car, what's the use? So first of all, whatever knowledge you have, you should do dawah, as the beloved Prophet Muhammad said, mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, ballighu anni walau aya, propagate even in one verse. But there is a technique of how you initiate, and if you do a dawah training course, we have given examples. For example, how to do dawah. For example, if you're traveling in a bus or a train and you have a non-Muslim sitting next to you, you know that you're going to part ways in the next 20 minutes. Now, how to do dawah in 20 minutes is a different technique. If you don't do dawah, you may never meet that non-Muslim ever in your life. The opportunity is lost. So you can't give a lecture of 2 hours to him, no? For example, if a person is, you know, maybe you have a lady who's a non-Muslim sitting next to you in a bus. You can't say, okay, sister, we have 20 minutes, let me talk to you about Islam. Will she give you time? No. You ask a simple question, what is the cross you're wearing? Simple question. At the back of your mind, was Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, crucified? If it is a Hindu, you ask a simple question. What is that Mangal Sutra? Talking about women's rights. What is the tikka you're wearing? So by asking an innocent question, it initiates dawa. I remember I was in a medical college. A majority were non-Muslim. You know, when we used to have lunch break together, you just make a simple statement. You know, that normally you know in colleges, there's East teasing, etc. So you ask a simple question to your friend, that what if someone teases your sister? Oh, someone teases my sister, I'll break his neck, I'll break his arm. I said, why? You tease somebody else's sister, it is good. When someone else teases your sister, you want to break the neck and break the arm. Talking about hijab. Oh, I make a simple statement that if certain men in the world are not allowed to marry more than one wife, women cannot live modestly in the world. What is Zakir saying? If some men in the world are not allowed to marry more than one wife, women as a whole cannot live modestly. What do you mean? I said, if you want the answer, 10 minutes. 10 minutes, I'll give you 20 minutes. Now, he is asking me time. I only made a statement to instigate, to initiate dawa while having food. When I made the statement, now he's saying, abhi maja aayega, abhi Zakir se will talk about polygamy. I tell him, see, I want 10 minutes, I will give you 20 minutes. Now when he's asking me time, he's paying attention. And now my answer comes about polygamy. So how you initiate dawa is a technique, innocently asking questions, getting into a conversation, whether you're in a plane, whether in a bus, whether in a train, whether it's a colleague in college. All these are techniques, sister. You can go to our website, irf.net, www.irf.net. You go to the section of dawa training program. And then there's a section dealing with dawa in details about techniques, about initiation, etc. This inshallah will help you, sister. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Zazakallah.
Are there any brothers or sisters who are non-Muslim would like to ask a question? Any non-Muslim brothers? Okay, fine. I believe the Muslims can make a queue here so that we don't have any. In between, if any non-Muslim like to ask a question, they're most welcome to come up to the queue. Yes, brother.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Aminuddin. My profession is engineering. Alhamdulillah. I have been watching your videos since...
I request the brothers to speak a bit slowly into the microphone and loudly. I'm speaking for 3 hours and you speak loudly. Like a Muslim, please. Loudly and clearly.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Aminuddin. My profession is engineering. I have been watching your videos since 10 years, around 10 to 15 years. Alhamdulillah, by your lectures, my total family is inspired and for spreading the dawa. My children are, alhamdulillah, they are, I mean, following your instructions, how to do dawa, everything. Alhamdulillah, but my view, my question is, when I want to start the dawa in non-Muslims, and I want to face the political influence from the government. Here in Arab countries, there is no pressure for the, against the Islam spreading the dawah. But in India, I am from India. In India, there is a lot of political pressure not to spread the Islam. So how to solve this problem?
Brother asked a very important question that you got inspired by my tape, family got inspired doing dawah. Here in the Gulf country, Muslim country, easy to dawah, but back home in India, you know, political pressure, difficult to dawah. Do you know, brother, the largest Islamic conference in the Islamic world history took place in Bombay? You know Bombay? Bombay, I agree, it's one of the most volatile city. You know, BJP, Bal Thackeray. If Allah is with you, and in Bombay, alhamdulillah, every year we have the annual largest dawah conference in the Islamic world history. in 1400 years in terms of technology, in terms of professionalism. Last year in 2009, we had 30 speakers from different parts of the world, more than 10 from USA, few from Canada, few from UK, from Saudi Arabia, from UAE, from Malaysia. We had more than 30 speakers, mashallah, for 10 days on over 35 acres of land.
We have watched already your two years.
Let me complete the answer. Do you want the answer or do you want to give the answer?
No, I want the answer from you.
Listen. With permission of the government, home ministry, foreign ministry, we know it is difficult, but if Allah's help is with you, alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah. We had 70 cameras, 70. There is no religious lecture in the world, no Christian lecture in the world which had 70 cameras live. We had 12,500 square feet of stage, mashallah. We had 300,000 capacity, out of which more than 25% were non-Muslims. In public, in the city of Bombay, mashallah, more than 100 people gave shahada. There were foreigners also who had come, mashallah. So what we have to say, that if you spread Islam in the right way, with hikmah, inshallah, I know there are problems. I will not get such a big gathering in a Muslim country also here. Fine, if I go to maybe Bangladesh or other part, I may get to Pakistan, but not in the Gulf countries. Because there we have 25% non-Muslims coming. The non-Muslims in Bombay are much more than all your Muslims put together here. Non-Muslim, 100,000 non-Muslims come from my talk. How much? 100,000 non-Muslims. Live, not on the channel. Channel, there are 30 million. How many? 30 million non-Muslims watching Peace TV. MashaAllah. 100,000 coming live. It is how you convey the message is important, and how well you organize, and how well you do publicity. How well you do publicity, how well you organize, and the professionalism is important. And with hikmah. Imagine in Bombay, a city which is difficult, the first city which had 100, which had 1 million viewers for 3 hours hardcore dawah was Bombay. There wasn't any Gulf country. Gulf country has come now with satellite channels. Before satellite channels started, in Bombay we had the cable TV. So how well you do it, and believe me, if Allah is with you, it is not we are intelligent, it is not because we have a lot of hikmah, it is because Allah's help is there. If Allah is with you, none can overcome you. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 160. If Allah helps you, none can overcome you. If Allah forsakes you, who is there then who can help you? So let the believers put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah also says in Surah Al-Kabut, chapter 29, verse 69, you strive in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will open up your pathways. So the main battlefield is there, mashallah. And believe me, the non-Muslims, they respect me more than the Muslims, do you know that? When I go in the police.
Muslims, not all non-Muslims. Some of the non-Muslims are respecting Muslims. And
most of the non-Muslims who know me respect me. Suppose 100,000 come, out of 100,000, inshallah, more than 80,000 will respect me. There are some who will not respect me, those who know me. A small percentage, less than 10% according to me. Because we in and out we go, mashallah, we meet all. And they know very well I'm talking about religion, I'm talking about Islam, I'm spreading my deen. I'm not doing it so that they respect me, so that they give me discount. And if it's a competition, Muslim and non-Muslim, non-Muslim will give me a better discount. You know, when we had the conference there in Bombay, a Muslim hotel, he's giving 10% discount. Non-Muslim giving me 75% discount for the hotel. Why? Because I see you on the television. Oh, such a good person spreading peace. 75% discount. The ground which we had, Somaya ground. You know Somaya ground? It is owned by BJP, huh? BJP, Kirti Somaya. You know, in the first year, he gave us 90% discount. Then he told me, doctor, please, this time I'll give you only 75% discount. I said, no problem. You know what is the cost of hiring the ground? 35 acres in Bombay. 35 acres in Mumbai for 1 month is no joke. It will cost you crores of rupees. So what the way you spread the message, you win them over. You don't defeat them, you win them over. Fine? So if you do according to Quran and Sunnah, inshallah you'll get results. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Zaki. Welcome back to Qatar. My question was, what is the philosophy of the Buddhist ideas? Do they worship as God or as a messenger of God? I have been waiting for this question for a long time, and I'm very glad to meet you in Qatar tonight.
Can you put the microphone close? Not like that, like that. Yeah.
Okay.
Ah, that's it. You said about the priest. Which priest?
No. I've been longing to see you for a long time, and my question is, what's the philosophy of the Buddhist? Did they worship him as God, or they consider him as a messenger before Islam?
My
second question is...
One question, brother. One question at a time. There are many people in the queue. You have to go behind the queue.
No, this is related to the question.
Brother, there are many people standing in the queue. Let's be fair to everyone, inshallah.
Okay.
So we'll give one person a chance, inshallah. So that, there's a question that what is the philosophy of the Buddhist? Do they believe in God? Do they believe messenger of God? As far as the Buddhists are concerned, the Buddhists are agnostic. Agnostic means a person who does not comment whether there is God or there's no God. They're silent. Neither do they say there is God, neither do they say there is no God. And Buddha, according to scholars, came at a time when there was too much of pantheism, too much of polytheism was there. At that time, he was silent regarding the concept of God. He didn't comment. So scholars say maybe he believed in a God, but because pantheism and polytheism was so common, he preferred remaining silent. But if you read the Buddhist scriptures and Dhammapada do claim about the coming of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if you read my scripture, if you read my book or hear my lecture on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures, it speaks about the prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the Buddhist scriptures. Gospel of Buddha, page number 114 by Karis, Dhammapad. It speaks about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how will he come. And if you are a Buddhist and you believe in these scriptures, you have to believe in the last Buddha, which is the Maitri. If you translate into English, it means the person who's merciful, the person who's praiseworthy, meaning Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hope that answers the question.
Doctor, we have another question from another Hindu brother.
Can you speak a bit slowly and loudly?
Sure, Doctor.
Loudly, you know, slowly.
Okay,
Doctor. You're just mumbling, so it becomes difficult for me to understand.
Okay. Doctor, there's a gentleman called Anand, and his question is it wrong for a Hindu to be brought up for a person to believe in Islam without converting? And even if he is believing, is it necessary to pray 5 times?
You asked me the question that is it necessary for a person to convert, if a Hindu believes in Islam, is it necessary for him to convert? It is like saying, I've gone to college. Once I go to school and college, is it required that I become educated or do I become literate? Once you go to college, immediately you become educated. Or once you go to college, you become literate. So if you believe in Islam, you believe in Islam. There's nothing like conversion per se. If you moment you believe and you submit your will, you become a Muslim. You don't have to do a third ceremony or get baptized or take a dip in the water. It's between you and Allah. If you submit your will to Almighty God, you're called as a person who submits his will. It's not required that you change your name unless your name involves shirk. As far as the second part of the question was concerned, that should he pray 5 times a day? See, once a person accepts Islam and stops shirks, that's the most important. But naturally, for a practicing Muslim, Salah is very important. It is the second pillar of Islam. After believing in one God, the second pillar of Islam is Salah. He should pray. If he says, if I don't pray 5 times, if I pray 4 times, is it fine? It is not fine. He may not get 100 out of 100. He may get 80. He may get 70 out of 100. Doesn't pray 5 times, they would pray 4 times. But best is to pray 5 times. But if you ask me, if he prays 4 times, will he go to Jannah? That depends upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But generally, yes, you should pray 5 times. Little bit here or there mistakes, if Allah wants to forgive, he'll forgive. The general ruling is the person who submits his will to Almighty God, and if he's a practicing Muslim, he should pray 5 times a day. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. I wanted to know, what is your suggestions for today's Muslim to deal with the present situation regarding media?
Sister has a question that what is my suggestion for present Muslims regarding how to deal with media. Sister, the full talk is over. Do you want me to give a talk again? The talk was dealing with that, what should the Muslims do regarding media? So if you want to hear the talk again, you can very well take the video cassette and hear it again. If you have any new question, inshallah, I can answer. The general answer is the same when I give a talk. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. My name is Laiba. I'm a student of class 4th. My question is that, can a Muslim girl be friends with a non-Muslim?
The young girl has asked a question, that can a Muslim girl be friends with a Christian girl, non-Muslim girl? Sister, if your intention is to convey the message of Islam to her, you should be friends with her. It's good. But intention should be that you get her to the straight path. And whenever there's friendship between a Muslim and a non-Muslim, either you are having more influence on your friend or your friend is having more influence on you. If your influence is more on the friend, continue the friendship and get them closer to the true. If their influence is more over you, then you desist from the friendship. When your friendship is there, you see to it that normally whenever friendship is there, there is some influence over each other. You cannot say, no, I'm a friend, I don't get influence. It's not possible at all. It is human psychology. So sister, if you have more influence on your friend and you keep on passing the correct message of Islam to her, my suggestion to you is continue the friendship and you do dawah to her and see to it that you convey the correct message of Islam and inshallah pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her hidayah. Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
My name is Mehwish. I am a student of class 4. My question is, when you will open the school in Qatar?
That's the best question ever.
The young sister has a question. She's in class 4. And when will I open a school in Qatar? I believe she may have seen on the Peach TV that we have a school by the name of Islamic International School in Bombay. We also have one in Chennai. And she's asking me the question, when will open in Qatar? I would say, Allahu Alam. And I think she has some inside information that we're in the process of starting opening schools in different parts of the world. We have done a survey, mashallah, to see the possibility of what is the impact. And though people know me for doing unconventional things, I believe in doing things which are unconventional, either unique or the best in the world. My always concept, either do something which is unique or do something which is the best. It may be possible you start with unique and also become the best in the world, alhamdulillah. So we do things which are unconventional. And those who watch Peace TV may realize they have seen some of our students on the television. We have started a school about 10 years back by the name of Islamic International School, which has a concept of a formal education along with the religious Islamic education. Our school is, inshallah, we teach them the national curriculum of UK, Cambridge University. And when they pass, they'll get the degree, inshallah, from the Cambridge University. So no one will say, you know, it's a Hindi school or a Muslim school. UK school, degree from UK. At the same time, we incorporate the Islamic studies. It's a unique school by itself. From the age of 3, when they join nursery, we teach Arabic and English together. And by the time they reach 5th or 6th, they can understand the major portion of the Quran. And by the time they reach, inshallah, 9th and 10th, they can translate about 95% accuracy to Quran. With that intention, we have a school which incorporates both the formal education as well as Islamic education. And it's unique by its way that the teacher-student ratio in Bombay, etc., it's normal 1:30. On the international level, it is 1:20. The good private schools of UK, Canada, USA, it's 1:12. Our school has a ratio of student-teacher ratio of 1:5. Wow. It's the lowest in the world. Wow. And the staff ratio to student is 1:2.5. Oh, it's actually 2, but for safety, I say 1:2.5. Last year, there were 400 students and 200 staff. According to the American survey that we hired a company, the Parthenon Group, they said there is no school in the world that they know of which has a student-teacher ratio of 1:5. They don't know of any school which has a ratio of 1:2, staff plus student. And with this concept, we have a philosophy that we teach them the Islamic education along with the form maths, history, geography, science, physics, along with Quran, Hadith, Sharia, Fiqh, in Arabic and English both. And along with that, swimming is compulsory, martial arts is compulsory. When a child reaches fifth standard, he has to become a black belt. If he's weak, if not in fifth, then sixth. We have more than 100 black belts in our school. There's no school in India which has 100 black belts. We have more than 100 Hufas in our school. There's no school that I know of, an English school in India, which has more than 100 Hufas. And all these Hufas, mashallah, they can translate the Quran to a great extent, alhamdulillah. So with this, I'm talking about the Bombay. The Bombay standard is a little bit higher than the Chennai standard. The Bombay ratio is much higher than the Chennai ratio. And with this concept, alhamdulillah, we have plans of opening schools in different parts of the world. At present, we have shortlisted a few cities. The first two we have decided, one is in Dhaka, and mashallah, we have the ambassador of Bangladesh here. So it's good news for him that we have planned to open a school in Dhaka, the first school outside India, as well as Dubai. And then we have plans to open other cities. On the list, we have Toronto on the list. We have London. Qatar is not there on the list at present, because there are many options. We have requests for more than 100 cities in the world to start schools. This school is class by itself. It's one of the most expensive schools. And we did a survey in Dubai that how many students, Parthenon is a service agency. It's an American firm. We did a survey there. They're the one who guide Harvard University, Hartford University, Cognita, Beacon House. They are one of the largest firms who advise to top institutions in the world. So we had them to do our survey. And when they did the survey of the schools in Dubai, they said that the people that go to superior premium school, super premium school, means very expensive school, there are 35,000 students in Dubai who go to schools which pay $16,000 to $20,000 a year. On average, about 70,000 dirham a year. 35,000 students. When they did a survey that would you like, and on average, there's no school in UAE which has more than 1 hour a day of Islamic studies, according to the survey. Some schools have half an hour, 1 hour, but not more than 1 hour. Our school has about 3.5 hours. Out of 7 hours of studies, 3.5 hours of Islamic studies. So when a survey was done, that how many students would like to study in a school which has got 3.5 hours studies, etc. First, they did a survey in Bombay, and Bombay results showed that if we charge 3 lakh fees, you only get 20 students will be able to afford, and only 5 will join your school. That was the survey. And we told the American company, you are wrong, we already have 200 students in our school. So they forgot the factor of Zakir Naik. So when they added the Zakir Naik factor, they got a total of maybe 720 students will join. It multiplied by 30x. The same when they did in Dubai. They put the factor that if open a school like IS, and if Dr. Zakir Naik runs the school, they got 18% of the students of 35,000 would jump the school to a new school. That means 7,000 students, not taking into factor that many new students would come in. So therefore, we found in the survey that Dubai is the most favorable, because Dubai, in education, they pay high. And our school is expensive, because the number of teachers we have, we pay very high salary. And on that, we have a concept of 25% scholarship. If what we believe, that if you don't have students who get scholarship, then my model will not run. Because normally what the concept is that every son thinks that he learned 3 to 4 times more than his father. So we have in a school in Bombay, mashallah, there are many fathers who own millions of dirhams, crores of rupees per month. 3 crores, 4 crores, 5 crores a month. At the same time, we have children earning 3,000-4,000 a month. That is 200-300 riyals a month. So now, I cannot afford, his father is earning 3 million riyals, I cannot pay him 6 million riyals per month, I cannot. But the person who is earning 300 riyals, surely I can pay him 600 to 1,000 riyals. I can pay him 2,000 riyals. I can pay him 20,000 rupees. So that is the reason what we believe, that we may not be able to convince all the students of the rich people to be full-time dais. But poor, at least we can to a great extent. So that is the reason in our school, we have 25% of the students on scholarship. But now the present school in Bombay is mainly the scholarship is funded by businessmen, which now I've got tired of, you know, approaching, you know, businessmen coming and doing. So we worked a business model. Now this model that we're going to start in Dubai and other parts of the world is a business model. We'll run the school professionally. And we'll tell the investor that, fine, we learn professionally, we may get 35-40% profit. The first 8% will go to you. The balance 30% or 32% will go to scholarship. If you want, you can write in a book of account that 30% donation from your side. But we will only give you 8% of the initial return to you. And whatever we make above that will go for scholarship. So it's not dependent on Zakir Naik. You know, today people are giving scholarship. Tomorrow, if I'm not, they will give scholarship to IIS in Bombay. And any project should not be dependent on one particular individual. It should be self-sufficient. When the project starts, for the first few years, it can be dependent. But the project should be such, in the next few years, it should be independent. So that's how whenever we launch a project, we see to it that we make it independent after about a few years. So that's the reason now, the new schools we are going to plan, the schools are going to be expensive. The cost of the school that we got surveyed in Dubai would cost us $45 million. $45 million. And mashallah, there are many investors. There are many investors who are willing, who have trust and faith in this, who are willing to invest. Now we will choose who we'll take. You create a demand, then you choose. In our school in Bombay, though the fees is one of the highest, it is the fifth in Bombay, out of every 3 persons paying full fees, we select one. We have rejected admission to minister's children, to millionaire's children. You create a demand. That means we aren't giving admission to everyone who wants. Then what we can do, we can implement rules. We tell, if you want admission, mother should do hijab, compulsory. If she doesn't do hijab, no admission. The millionaire comes, do you offer salah? Only Jummah to Jummah. I said, don't put your child. He said, why? Because, you know, we'll teach to your child in our school, according to the hadith of Sahih Muslim, the difference between iman and kufr is salah, so maybe your son will call you a kafir. No, I want admission. What will you do? I will pray 5 times. He gives in writing, I'll pray 5 times. In the missionary school, they are forcing you to do shirk. You're paying donation, and they're forcing you to do shirk. In our school, no donation. You have to qualify. Then we force you to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's compulsory that the mother should attend once a week our religious lectures. If they don't have time, no admission. Father, once a fortnight. We have got so stringent rules, mashallah. Because of the demand, you create a demand, and then you dictate. This is all professionalism. So now, mashallah, now we are launching a pamphlet called as Early Birds. Now many investors want to come with us. What we are doing, we will choose now. The demand is there. 8% return to you first, above that sawab. Now we will take who we want. So we will select. And in this way, inshallah, we plan to open schools in other cities of the world. We have done a survey even of Saudi cities, but the survey wasn't that favorable. Because what they pay for schools in Saudi Arabia, according to the survey, is very low. The highest school in Riyadh is Mamlika. The charge is very little, hardly about 30,000, 40,000 riyals in dollars they had given me, about 10,000. Compared to Dubai, Gems World School, they charge $25,000 on the higher side, 90,000 riyal. So the demand for education is more in Dubai. So when we have the best of teachers, we don't want to pay peanuts to our teachers. If you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. You pay almonds, you get human beings. All our employees in a foundation, if he's working for a corporate company, if he joins us, we pay him 20% more. We don't say, oh, if you're earning 10,000 rupees, join for 5,000 for Allah's sake. If you're earning 10,000, we'll give you 12,000. If you're earning 100,000, we will give you 120,000. We'll give you 20% more than the corporate company. We have got employees, mashallah, who are paid top salaries in our firm, even in the Peace TV. We don't believe that if you're doing for Allah, then do it at discount. See, we are, Allah has given us, so I'm doing free, mashallah. And the more free we do, the more Allah gives us. And the more we give to Allah, the more Allah gives us, mashallah. So in this concept, we have plans of opening schools in different parts of the world. Initially shortlisted 4 cities. We'll continue, and depending upon how much ability and what the demand is in per city, based on that, we will have this school, inshallah. So that we create duats. We want to create a future generation. So that the future generation, when they come out, and that's what we created a demand in for the Islamic Qaris, for what we do. What we do, a survey that the graduates, we have many graduates from Medina, from Al-Azhar Cairo, we see what is the maximum salary they're getting. What they get maximum from foreign countries, we give them more. So there's no chances of them jumping from our school. The highest salary what they get from foreign countries, they're on kafala, we pay them more than them. So once we pay them more, where is the question of jumping? We give them facilities, and what when we take care of them, they take care of our students. So that's the reason, mashallah, we have new concepts. We have even imported the concept which is done in Haram, where they do hifz in 2 months' time. They complete the hifz of the full Quran in 2 months' time. So there's a course that's conducted for several years in Makkah under the Islamic Ministry of Saudi Arabia. And there they have a course where they select 60 students. In 2 months, they make them do hifz. But there the ratio is for every student, they have, for every 4 or 5 students, they have 1 qari. In Bombay, for every 2 students, they have 1 qari. One teacher is teaching only 2 students. And in 2 months, mashallah, they do hifz of the Quran. And then the next years, they come 1 hour every day in the morning and they do muraja. So this new concept we started, mashallah, it had tremendous effect. Our Huffar said, Zakir is crazy. It's not possible. But then, mashallah, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the first batch was very successful. We had the second batch this year. So in this way, mashallah, we do things which are unconventional. And at the same time, we are creating quality. Our students, mashallah, can speak fluent English, Arabic, science and technology all put together, martial arts, swimming, computers, technology. And when they appear in the IGCSC, normally you have to appear in 5 subjects. Our students are appearing in 9 subjects. If you pass in any 5, you get the certificate. But besides the normal subjects of English, physics, biology, chemistry, maths, 5 subjects. We have business studies, ICT, information technology, Arabic language, Islamic studies, 9. They have to pass in any 4, inshallah, we want them to get good marks in all 9. So in this way, mashallah, we have developed many things.
Was that, and our said professor had prepared a question paper for a college that provoked blasphemy under Prophet ﷺ. Is this any way okay in Islam?
Brother asked a question that there's a Muslim in Kerala, and I know this was in the media for the past few weeks. And there was a professor who wrote certain questions against Muhammad ﷺ in the examination. A Muslim man chopped off his hand. See, we have to follow the law of the country. The Islamic State, we have to take him to a Qazi. But India not being an Islamic state, you can't take the law in your hand. So it's not part of Islam. But the point to be noted here is, a few years back, a communist attacked a BJP leader in Kerala and killed him. That didn't come in news. Why? What my question is, a communist who spoke against a BJP professor who spoke, promoted Hinduism, this communist killed him. It came as news, brief, finish. Now this Muslim chops off the hand. It's coming for days together. Why? Why? That my question is why. Both are wrong. But the bigger crime is killing. Chopping of hand is also wrong, but smaller crime. For the big crime, it comes news brief, one day finish. Now this yet, so much that the person is asking me. I doubt whether that Hindu is asking the question knows that a Hindu was killed by a communist in Kerala. We know that, I'm sure no. What we have to know, that we being in the field, we should try and do a bit research. But the act is, Islam is a religion of peace. What the person did is wrong. What happens, as I mentioned earlier in my talk, they pick up the black sheep of the community and they portray as those exemplars. This is commonly happening in India. It is not unique, but when a Muslim does it, it's highlighted. And everyone thinks only Muslims do it. As I told you, Maoist, what the Maoist kill Indians is the maximum in number. What the Hindus kill, Hindu terrorist organization, is much more than what the Muslims do. That doesn't justify it gives right for a Muslim to kill an innocent human being. No, no. I'm not trying to justify that because the Hindus kill, even the Muslim can kill. What I'm trying to tell you, what the Muslim is doing is misguided. He's a black sheep of the community, but yet he's a minority as compared to the non-Muslims. So we have to let this be known to the media. So this is the double standards of the media. Double standards of the media. So this is how they, like, you know, people ask me in the Indian press that, oh, Muslims are terrorists. So I said, who told you? You hear in the Western media. So I asked them the question, do you consider Bhagat Singh to be terrorist? They said, no. I said, even I don't consider him to be terrorist. When the same UK people 60 years back called Bhagat Singh a terrorist, I disagree, you disagree. Now the same UK media, Westerners, are calling Muslim terrorists. Why do you agree? Double standards. So journalist is laughing. Bhagat Singh, when the Western media says terrorist, we say, no, he's a patriot. The same Western media blaming the Muslim, then you agree. Why? So why these double standards? You do a research. There may be black sheep among the Muslims, but why do you just agree with what the Western media say without really checking them? Hope that answers the question.
Assalamu alaikum. One of my friends asked me a question. Can we do job in banks? And I'm also confused about it.
Sister has a question that a friend asked, that can we work in a bank? If it's an Islamic bank, yes. If it's a conventional bank based on riba interest, it is haram. Because there are no less than 8 different places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that riba is haram. And Allah clearly says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 278, that those who do not give up the demands of riba, of interest, then take notice of a war from Allah and His Rasul. So if you deal in riba, the Quran says Allah and His Rasul will wage a war against you. There are other big sins, but riba is not only a big sin, it is Allah and His Rasul will wage a war. Therefore, taking interest, giving interest, working in a bank, being a witness, all is haram. But if you work in an Islamic bank, which is based on the Sharia principles, it's perfectly fine. But working in a conventional bank based on riba is totally wrong. Hope that answers the question.
Hello, my name is Irfan. I'm an engineer by profession, and I have a question related to the topic that you spoke about. You brought up a very good point about the media, as media can break or make. One of the things that the media can do is if it spreads negative propaganda. And the second part of the damage is that how it's perceived. So my question is that what would be one of the key things that Muslims, when they are exposed to such negative media, how they should react to antagonism and things of that sort. Thanks.
Brother asked the question that he does agree with my speech that media can make and break. How should the Muslims react? As far as reaction to the media is concerned, the media today is doing more damage for the human beings than good. The media does more damage, even for the Muslims. Leave aside non-Muslims, even the Muslims, they are so hooked on to the media and more of the entertainment and the haram media rather than the good media. It's causing more damage. And as I rightly said, it can convert day into night, black into white, hero into villain, villain into hero. And for a layman, it's difficult to decipher. And one such example is just a few months back. Though I avoid coming on talk shows, I'd come on a talk show in the Indian media on NDTV. On the panel was Shah Rukh Khan, Karan Johar, and some other personalities, including myself. And we always have a policy that I will come along with my cameras. And Barka Dutt was the anchor, so you might have heard of. But she's very popular in doing anchoring. So we had a condition that if you allow our cameras, we'll come, otherwise we won't come. She agreed. Her manager agreed. Last moment they said, sorry. Anyhow, the replies I gave were edited. It made me say things which I did not say. This is how the media, for example, if I take an interview, and if you ask you that, what is your view regarding George Bush? So if you say George Bush is not good, I will chop off the knot and make you hear George Bush is good. And when I show you your interview, you will think it's a slip of the tongue. You won't realize how I've done it. What do you say? No, Brother Zakir, it was a slip of the tongue. I said George Bush is good. Actually, what I wanted to say was George Bush was not good. Actually, you said George Bush was not good. But I edit your answer in such a way, it seems you have said George Bush is good. So this is the media. So this is what they did, and they had, what we had a counter show on Peace TV. We had a show called TV Talk and Analysis. And they did postmortem that how a person can play with the media and how a Muslim should be careful with the media. That what you see on the television with your eyes and what you hear with your ears may not always be the fact. Therefore, the intention and the integrity and the honesty of the host and the producer is very important. If the intention, the honesty, integrity of the host who's taking the interview or the producer is in doubt, he can exactly convey the opposite message what the person is conveying. Therefore, what you see on news channels is not always correct. Therefore, according to my personal view, this is my personal view, people may differ, I consider the news channel to be more bad for the Muslims than even the haram entertainment channels. You know why? On the haram entertainment channel, you're doing one sin. It is wrong. I'm not in favor. But the news channel is attacking your iman. It's leading you toward kufr. So according to me, it's my opinion, I may be wrong. According to me, I believe that a news channel is more dangerous for a Muslim even than a pornographic channel. That doesn't mean you should watch pornographic channel, don't get me wrong. This is my analysis. Pornographic channel, because you know it is haram, like how I say that riba is more bad than having drugs. How? It is so bad. Why? Because in the Quran, intoxicants is haram. Riba, besides being haram, Allah and Rasul will wage a war against you. So when I say this, they understand how haram is riba. Similarly, when I say pornographic channel, every Muslim agrees. It's haram. Why? Because pornographic channel is haram. But the news channel, it is attacking your iman. It's leading you towards kufr. It's more dangerous, more harmful according to me. Because when they portray the news, they do it with so much sophistication that you tend to believe in that. So me being a man of the media, for me it's difficult to decipher. Being a man of the media, knowing in and out about editing, That's my field, that's my specialty. So they can play havoc with it. So that's the reason you cannot always believe what you see and you cannot believe what you hear. Therefore, the Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 6, whenever you get information, you check it up before you pass it on to the third person. Hope that answers the question. And I think it's getting late. We'll allow one last question before we end the session.
Hello. Doctor, there's another question from a Christian brother named Joseph. And the question is, as we knew about in the beginning, human being as Adam and Hawa, my question is, that is Islam never to marry brothers and sisters, then how this generation occurred?
Brother asked the question that, being a Christian, he knows that the first pair of human beings on the face of the earth were Adam and Eve. May Allah be pleased with them both. May peace be upon them both. So, how did the generation grow? Did they marry brothers and sisters, which is haram? Now, as far as Islam is concerned, marrying brothers and sisters is haram. But previously, the law was different. Previously, the law was that brothers and sisters in the same delivery, they were prohibited to marry. Brothers and sisters in the same delivery. If they were brothers and sisters of different deliveries, they could marry. The law keeps on changing. The basic law of Tawheed remained the same, but the minute details do change. So previously, the law was brothers and sisters in the same delivery prohibited. Now, because humanity is in large numbers, the law now is that brothers, sisters, irrespective, same or other delivery, they are prohibited to marry. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.